believe you were very clear on Tuesday as well that in the proffers we could argue rebuttal evidence as it relates to the evidence that was submitted by defense counsel after the evidence was closed. And that's merely what it is. It's rebuttal evidence as it relates to the cell phone records or analysis that was done by the non-expert, Bob and Mr. Sadow.
All right. Mr. Killen.
As it relates to the proffered evidence, our proffered evidence would be in direct rebuttal to testimony given in the courtroom, particularly by Mr. Bradley. So we would have a direct rebuttal of that. That's what our proffer will be. I understand the court's ruling. Just want to put that on the record.
So we know the context of it. Is that similar for Mr. Cromwell as well?
It is.
And just solely relates to Mr. Bradley's testimony?
It does.
Okay. All right. All right, noted. Anything else then?
Your Honor, the proffered evidence is basically would corroborate what has been admitted in evidence as Exhibit 39, but chronological text.
Okay. All right. Then if there is nothing else, I'll turn it over to Ms. Merchant to begin on behalf of the defense.
Sorry, Judge. Unfortunately, you're stuck with me today.
Understood.
May it please the court, Your Honor, John Merchant on behalf of Mr. Roman. Just by way of roadmap, to give you some idea about the allocation of time and what I'm going to be covering, I've been charged with talking to Your Honor about the conflict issue and the appearance of a conflict and what we believe the evidence to show on that issue. Mr. Sadow, Mr. Gillum will be talking more about the forensic misconduct piece of it, Ms. Willis's church speech, statements made to the media, fraud on the court, frankly, and the book that she gave several interviews for. So I won't be discussing any of those issues. So if you like to ask me, certainly I can try to address them, but that's going to be the focus of their presentation. And then towards the end, other folks may have issue-specific type arguments, either in follow-up to mine or the forensic misconduct. But those are the two lanes that we're going to be covering, but I'm going to do the conflict piece of it for you. And on that issue, Your Honor, this is a matter of first impression in Georgia. I can't find a single case that's been published by the Court of Appeals or the Supreme Court that is based on these facts. There are, of course, a number of different appellate court cases that deal with conflict-related issues, and more importantly, appearance of conflict-related issues. And some of those are based in state law. Some of them are based on the ethical rules that govern lawyers. Some of them are based upon the Sixth Amendment right to due process that's implicit in all of what we're doing here today. I want to remind the court that we're here today on this motion to disqualify D.A. Willis and her office because of her judgment, frankly. She is supposed to be disinterested under the Sixth Amendment, and she's anything but that. The fact that these proceedings have taken this long and through the convoluted way we've made it here today explain that. So as I present my arguments, I want the court to understand that this court represents the guardrails for the Sixth Amendment in this context, and Ms. Willis has already been disqualified once. So I would encourage the court to remember what Judge McBurney did in his order disqualifying. The same argument was made in that case as to whether or not there needs to be an actual conflict of interest or whether or not the appearance of a conflict of interest might be sufficient under the facts. I want to make clear to the court that the law in Georgia suggests and is very clear that we can demonstrate an appearance of a conflict of interest, and that is sufficient. I'm going to be candid with the court. There is a Supreme Court decision from 1996, Lamb v. State, and then there are two Court of Appeal decisions after that deal, and frankly, in some dicta that suggests that an actual conflict is required. But the Supreme Court of Georgia, since those decisions came down, has made quite clear that the appearance of a conflict standard still applies. And the reason that's important is I think under the Sixth Amendment, which is where we're at, in order to preserve the defendant's rights under that under that provision and under corollary provisions of Georgia law, you've got to consider the appearance of a conflict. And the reason why the appearance of a conflict is so prescient here is because if this court allows this kind of behavior to go on and allows DAs across the state by its order to engage in these kinds of activities, the entire public confidence in the system will be shot. And the integrity of the system will be undermined. And so with those sort of public policy and constitutional principles, I wanted to turn to the law in Georgia on disqualification. And, Your Honor, I'm gonna give you the law, and then I'm going to talk about the facts and how they apply to the law at the end. If you want to talk about the facts earlier, jump right in, and I'll be happy to do that. I'm sure Your Honor is very well prepared and probably knows all the law that I'm going to cite to you. But to give the skeleton outline, the original seminal case that deals with conflict of interest from the Georgia Supreme Court is Williams v. State. That's 258 Georgia 305. And there are basically two methods by which you can disqualify a district attorney. One of them is a conflict of interest, and I'll suggest to the court that doesn't mean an actual conflict. That could mean an appearance of conflict as well, and then forensic misconduct. Importantly, in the Williams case, though, in footnote 4, and I think this is important for the court's analysis about the facts and which box it fits into, the court said there is no clear demarcation line between conflict of interest and forensic misconduct, and a given ground for disqualification of the prosecutor might be classifiable as either. And I think that's important because we have facts that fit in both boxes. So if a state stands up and says, well, there's no actual conflict here, Judge, that doesn't mean necessarily that it doesn't apply to the forensic misconduct. Typically, forensic misconduct relates to statements of the prosecutor designed to impugn the character of the defendant before trial and to affect the jury pool, which we have here, which I'm not going to discuss. But the facts that we have here very much relate to that issue, and there's crossover. Importantly, and I think this is important for the court's consideration of what effect the court's ruling may have, if you deny this motion, there's a good chance, if it's reversed, that we would be granted a new trial. So that means we're going to have to do this all over again. In Amusement Sales versus State, 316 Georgia Appellate 727, that's a case that cites Whitworth, which is physical precedent only. The court said, if the assigned prosecutor has acquired a personal interest or stake in the conviction, the trial court abuses its discretion in denying a motion to disqualify him, and the defendant is entitled to a new trial, even without a showing of prejudice. So that means if we show the court today, and I think we have through the proceedings today and before, that Ms. Willis has developed a very personal interest in this case, and Your Honor denies this motion, we're coming back all over again if the appellate court say you were wrong.
So what is that personal interest?
So the personal interest can be, there's no definition of that under Georgia law, and it could be a personal financial interest. It could be a personal interest related to bias against a particular defendant, which sort of falls into the forensic misconduct box. But we have here a very personal financial interest that's been laid out in terms of money received by Ms. Willis as a result of the scheme that she set up. To get to the issue of the personal interest in the context of an appearance, I think that's important. I do want to suggest to the court that there are a number of cases that post-date this actual conflict of interest language that's suggested in some of the cases from the 90s, that you have to pay attention to what this looks like to the public. And I agree with all of the law, and I'm sure the state's going to stand up here and say it can't be a speculative or a conjectural type of personal interest. We don't have that here. We have something very concrete, and as Judge McBurney put it, actual and palpable, not speculative and remote. That's exactly what we have here. We've demonstrated through the testimony of the witnesses, some of whom impeached themselves, that we have a very personal interest. In the seminal United States court case that deals with prosecutorial impropriety is Young v. U.S. That's a 481 U.S. 787 case. In that case, it's the opportunity for conflicts to arise that created at least the appearance of impropriety. And that's the case that requires that the prosecutor be disinterested. Since a scheme injecting a personal interest, financial or otherwise, into the enforcement process may bring irrelevant and impermissible factors into the prosecutorial decision. Now, there are a number of Georgia cases that sort of repeat that theme. Reeves v. State, 231, Georgia Appellate 22, that's a 1998 case, stated a potential conflict of interest existed and the appearance of impropriety existed. Davenport v. State, 157, Georgia Appellate 704, that's a 1981 case. That was decided 7 years before Williams. When there is at least the appearance of impropriety, a defendant is denied fundamental fairness in the state's prosecution of the charges against him or her. There are also rules that govern prosecutors. Lawyers in general are bound to preserve and avoid even the appearance of impropriety. That's Brown v. State, 256, Georgia Appellate, 603-202, 2002. Head v. State, a prosecutor's close personal relationship with the victim in a case may create at least the appearance of a prosecution unfairly based on private interest rather than one properly based on vindication of public interest. ABA Criminal Justice Standards for the Prosecution Function Standard 3.3-1.2C. A prosecutor should avoid appearance of impropriety in performing the prosecution function. 3-1.7F. The prosecutor should not permit the prosecutor's professional judgment or obligations to be affected by the prosecutor's personal, political, financial, professional, business, property, or other interests or relationships. So the rules that govern her in her own profession say that this is wrong because she's developed a financial interest in this case. And at the very least, created the appearance of unfairness towards these defendants by setting up a relationship, a prosecutorial relationship with her boyfriend that she'd been dating for 2 years, according to the testimony. So before I move, Your Honor, to the specific facts, I you asked, you know, what's personal interest? And I think, frankly, as I was trying to figure this out, I think you know it when you see it. It's just like in the concurrence in Jacobellis versus State of Ohio, the Supreme Court case from 1964, Justice Stewart in his concurrent opinion said, I know it when I see it, talking about obscenity. I think you know it when you see it. I think there's enough facts in front of you that you know it when you see it. And so I think that the governing principle helps enlighten some of the facts here. And also, I think it's not just financial. In McLaughlin v. State, I think the court's very familiar with that case, 295 Georgia 609, 2014. The Supreme Court essentially said that because the acting DA had become a witness in the case and developed a personal interest in the case due to his daughter's relationship with the victim, that he was disqualified. And because he was disqualified, his entire office was disqualified. So turning to the facts of the case, Your Honor, I think I've got my role is 20 minutes, so I've got about 8 minutes left. So why the relationship? Why did we spend so much time on a relationship between these two people? We frankly couldn't care less if they had a personal relationship outside of work. That is not what the issue is here. The issue is that they began this relationship in 2019. They were dating for 2 years. And then she awarded him a contract where public money, either from Fulton County or the state of Georgia, ended up in his pockets. That decision alone was improper. But what's even more improper is that then she and he used that money to go on personal vacations and trips. If Your Honor will remember, Exhibits 9, 11, and 12 dealt with the expenditures by Wade. On trips, if you do the math on that, if you look at what he spent, and then you look at the testimony about what was paid back by Willis, because the cash reimbursement theory, I'll talk about in a second, but if you do the math on what he actually paid for and what they testified she paid back in cash, you still have over $9,200, $9,247 to be exact. Is the amount of money they cannot account for in their testimony. And as Your Honor will remember, there was no mention of cash in Mr. Wade's affidavit when the best and first opportunity to raise that issue would have come up is when the state filed their response in his affidavit. That is nowhere to be found in there. The first time we heard about cash was here in this courtroom. And so I think she's received a personal financial benefit of over $9,200 in this case that she can't account for and the state can't account for. And the reason we can't account for it is because they came up with a cash theory. Cash theory only raises.
Before we get into that, let me ask you this. Let's say they couldn't have, let's say the theory wasn't even there that they had paid it back or that there'd been any exchange. Should there first be a consideration of a materiality requirement?
No.
Have you seen that in this jurisdiction? It's not in this jurisdiction. Have you seen that in any other jurisdiction?
I haven't seen that, Judge. And if it was $6, that would still be improper.
Would it be improper where it's a per se disqualification if someone, you know, buys their boss a stick of gum? Is that per se disqualifying because there's no materiality requirement?
I don't disagree that it may not meet a materiality requirement, but it's a personal benefit. I won't say that giving a pack of gum is just justification for disqualifying a district attorney. I think that's part of the issue, Judge. I think it's a fact-based inquiry by you.
So there's a continuum involved here.
Yeah, I think the continuum involves you looking at whether or not in the grand scheme of things it violates the Constitution, and whether or not there's an appearance of a conflict, and the appearance suggests that she actually received a benefit, and we know that she did. They admitted it. We don't have to speculate about that. They said that she said she got a benefit, and she said she paid back certain amounts. In that regard, Your Honor, I don't know, would $100 be enough? Would $200 be enough? I think you have to look at it globally and consider all of the witnesses, consider all of the facts, consider the credibility of the witnesses, frankly. Right. I mean, Your Honor sat here and watched everybody, so I haven't spent a lot of time going into the specific testimony because Your Honor is well aware of it. But you get to evaluate the credibility of the witnesses as a fact finder. And, you know,
just from a legal perspective, though, you're saying we can't just say dollar amount, look no further. There has to be a totality of the circumstances analysis.
I think it's fact specific, Judge. I don't really want you to pin me down on that because there's no law on it. I can't give you a straight answer because I haven't seen anything like that. And I think if we build a materiality requirement into the case law, then you're down a slippery slope then, because then it's going to be very, the appellate courts are going to be deciding, well, is $50 enough? Is $100 enough? So I think it's not necessarily the amount of the money. It's the fact that she received it, and it's not insignificant. And I don't think your order has to say because she received $9,200, she's disqualified. I think if we go back to the 20,000 foot level, what's the appearance here? Is this fairness to the defendants? Does it appear that she is interested in this prosecution, or does it appear that she's disinterested? She took the stand. You can tell she's not a disinterested person when it comes to this proceeding, but we also argue she's not a disinterested person when it comes to the prosecution as a whole. I'm going to leave for I'll resist the temptation to defend my wife, and who I believe to be an excellent lawyer and a member of the bar for 20 years. In good standing. But I will say this, Judge, you don't just evaluate the credibility of the witnesses. You evaluate the credibility of the lawyers. And Mr. Abadi stood up here in open court in front of national news and in the national public and called her a liar. I need to address that for 1 minute. The text messages that are now part of the record, which now are substantive evidence for you to consider, prove everything that she put in that motion. Everything that she tried to elicit from Mr. Bradley was absolutely 100% true. And not only was it true, she verified through the witness himself that the motion was accurate before it was filed. So for the state to get up here and impugn her credibility, it's not only improper, it violates Berger versus United States, which is a case that says the state can't just get up here and make any argument it wants. And I encourage the court to call him out on it when he steps up here. We have to have candor towards the tribunal. You cannot lie to the court, cannot lie to the public, cannot lie to the jury. And I think that's what he did. So there's other corroboration of our view that she was in this relationship. I think, frankly, based on Mr. Bradley's testimony, Your Honor can separate the wheat from the chaff when it comes to credibility. But Mr. Bradley had two chances to correct information that he suddenly developed amnesia about, and he just didn't do it.
How does the timing of the relationship impact a financial interest?
Because it's part of the scheme she created intentionally in order to give benefits to her boyfriend. So they had, there's a reason why they fought so hard on this, Judge. I mean, there's a reason that every single subpoena was objected to. Every single question we asked Mr. Bradley was objected to. The jumping up and down, all of the obfuscation. There's a reason for that. They know that if Your Honor finds that that relationship started in 2019, that the appointment of Wade itself was improper. And if that was improper, then he had no business as an average citizen, along with the fact that they didn't have approval from Fulton County to appoint him in the first place, that undermines the indictment. It creates a structural impairment in the indictment because he had no more business being in the grand jury room than I did. So that's what they're worried about. And the reason why it's important for the financial piece, Judge, is it's how the money ended up going back to her. She put her boyfriend in the spot, paid him, and then reaped the benefits from it. That she created the system and then didn't tell anybody about it. She didn't even tell her dad about it. So I think if in the grand scheme of things, if you're looking at the totality of the facts, and I've got to sit down here in about 2 minutes to make room for my co-counsel. If you look at it, everything put together, judges, they did this. They knew it was wrong. They hid it. And even when they were called out on it, they tried to create an excuse for it by saying it happened after the fact. We know now from the testimony, Ms. Yerdy confirmed that Mr. Bradley, his text messages were accurate, not his in-court testimony, but that fact was accurate. The motion is accurate. And so also, I do want to point out there's no paper trail here for the cash. I know that this was she and her father both testified that they kept cash on hand, which, I mean, keeping cash on hand in and of itself is not a problem. When you're a public official and you're required to keep track of gifts that you receive, then you need to keep track of it. But there's no paper trail. There's no deposit history. There's no withdrawal history. There's no receipts. None of that. So even assuming their testimony could be credible, and we don't think that it is, you still don't have enough information to track all that money that she received. And this is just what we know
about. But does the lack of evidence fall on the state? Does the lack of evidence fall on the state? Isn't that where burdens come in?
Yeah, yes, I think they had an obligation to tell Your Honor, hey, this is where the money went. And they certainly had the ability to do that if they could do it. Since they didn't do it, we have to assume they can't. And if they can't, I just want to remind the court of a very important piece of testimony from Ms. Willis that I think goes to credibility of all of the officers of the court who testified. She met with Wade, and they developed, in 10 minutes after talking about the financial piece, I believe, this cash theory that could not be rebutted. We have no ability to do that. They did, and they chose not to do it. So with that, Your Honor, unless Your Honor has more questions for me, I'm going to sit down and turn the podium over to my distinguished colleague, Mr. Sadow.
Thank you, Mr. Merchant.
Appreciate the court's time.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. I'm going to speak to what I would call a subset of forensic misconduct. And I'm going to assume that all the law that's been provided to you in pleadings as well as emails, you know, you don't need me to tell you what the law is. So I want to just set up how the disqualification and then dismissal of the indictment should take place under the subset of forensic misconduct. Roman's counsel, Ms. Merchant, filed on January 8 her pleading, her motion to dismiss and to disqualify. We were in court that Friday of that week in which I made it known that President Trump, may adopt that motion. I wanted to see what was going to happen before I did so. That Sunday, which would be January the 14th, 2024, D.A. Willis took it upon herself to go to a historic black church in Atlanta, having not responded at all to the motion of Ms. Merchant's client, Roman. And she made what we now call the church speech, and Your Honor has reference to that. You didn't necessarily want evidence on that, but you know what the church speech was. It was videoed. It was clear that Ms. Willis had notes. She was reading from notes that she had prepared. It was a calculated determination by Ms. Willis to prejudice the defendants and their counsel. How so? By making an issue out of the fact that the person that was challenged in the Roman motion was black, without telling the public or the church members or anyone for that matter that the reason that Mr. Wade was being challenged was not because he was black, had nothing to do with race. It had to do with the relationship that had been alleged and later admitted to by Ms. Merchant. Ms. Willis took full opportunity to prejudice the defendants and then comes along later in a pleading and says it wasn't designed or intended to be at the defendants at all or the defense counsel, which with all due respect is just nonsense. The purpose of that was to get public sympathy, public empathy for what Ms. Merchant had already alleged in her motion. Now, that was a violation of the professional rules of conduct. It was a violation of 3.8G. There's no question about it. It wasn't in response to anything that was said. It was a public statement, extrajudicial, for the purpose of making a comment upon the defendants.
It would be in response to a motion that was filed.
But it wasn't filed in a response, in a pleading. It was filed in response to a motion. And the motion were allegations made. If Ms. Willis wanted to respond at that point, she could have said the facts of the matter. Instead, she misstated what the situation was, took advantage of the opportunity, an ethical violation, and the ethical violation makes it clear that you must refrain from making extrajudicial comments that have a substantial likelihood of heightening public condemnation of the accused. Can you think of anything more that would heighten public condemnation of the defendants than alleging that defense counsel and the defendants were making their motion based on race and religion? That's as bad as it gets in Fulton County, with all due respect. That's exactly what Ms. Willis wanted done. And remember, the state still had not responded. So then what we get from the state is we get an affidavit filed as part of their response. And that affidavit says specifically, and the affidavit is Mr. Wade, says specifically in paragraph 26 and 27 that the relationship did not begin until 2022. It acknowledges the relationship and says it didn't begin until 2022. And the pleading that's filed, the state's pleading and response, indicates not exactly that, but it says there was no relationship as of November 1 of 2021, and that's on page 7. So now we know that timing is the issue, because Ms. Merchant made it clear that we alleged and had evidence that indicated the timing was before Mr. Wade was hired, not after. So the state now has filed an affidavit and a pleading that claims post-hiring into 2022. And then Mr. Wade, Willis testify to the same thing under oath. Now, Ms. Yerty says it began in 2019. Why would she know? Well, she would know because she was a former friend. I know the state's going to get up here and say, you can't believe, essentially what they're going to say is you can't believe any defense witness because they're defense witnesses. And only people that would tell the truth would be Wade and Willis. I suggest to you that that's not accurate. I suggest that the testimony that Mr. Wade gave and Ms. Willis gave, and I'm specifically dealing now with the timing issue, without getting into anything else, that brought forth a true concern about their truthfulness and being what is required of a lawyer in this state, which is candor toward the tribunal. And that's 3.3 of the professional rules. Specifically, small A1, make a false statement of material fact or law to a tribunal. So that's, as I posited to the court, that's the second ethical violation. And then you also have 8.4 of the professional rules that says it's a violation of the Georgia Rules of Professional Conduct for a lawyer to, and that's A4, engage in a professional conduct involving dishonesty, fraud, deceit, or misrepresentation. Now, do you have to find that Wade and Willis lied? No. What you need to be able to find is that there is a concern, a legitimate concern based on the evidence in this case about their truthfulness, a legitimate concern about the truthfulness, which equates to an appearance of impropriety. Because once you have the appearance of impropriety under forensic misconduct, the law in Georgia is clear, that's enough to disqualify. So why should you find there's a concern with their truthfulness? ERT is the first one. You have that testimony. But then we go to what is the most obvious indication that Willis and Wade were not truthful on the point of timing, and that's Bradley. Defense Exhibit 26 came into evidence. Defense Exhibit 26 comes in and says, and you know I went into this the last hearing. It says that on January the 5th, 2024, at approximately 9:49 a.m., there's text messages that are exchanged between Ms. Merchant and Mr. Bradley. And the text messages go like just date, and that's from Ms. Merchant. Ms. Merchant says, do you think it started before she hired him? Bradley, who we now know from Defense Exhibit 39, has been texting with Ms. Merchant for a number of months. This is not the first time. This is months within the communications between the two. Mr. Bradley says, absolutely. Now, absolutely is not a speculative word. That's not speculation. That's a definitive statement. And Bradley then, unprompted, says this. And unprompted is important. It started when she left the DA's office and was a judge in South Fulton. Goes on, Ms. Merchant says, she liked it started when she left the DA's office with the appropriate emoji or whatever one would call it to say it was liked. And then Mr. Bradley say they met at the municipal court CLE conference. Again, unprompted. He's now definitively telling Ms. Merchant when this relationship started. Ms. Merchant says, that's what I figured when he was married. And then Ms. Merchant says, and we're now talking about a couple hours later, she texts and says, upon information and belief, Willis and Wade met while both were serving as magistrate judges and began a romantic relationship at that time. And Mr. Bradley responds, no, municipal court, thank you. Doesn't say it didn't start then. He doesn't suggest that she's wrong, other than magistrate court municipal. Now we have that, and it's in evidence. And what does Bradley do? He knows that he's put himself in a position that if he testifies truthfully on the witness stand, Your Honor is in a position to be able to find, if you choose to, that both Willis and Wade lied. So what does Bradley do? Look, you were an assistant U.S. attorney. You know how this works when you have witnesses in this situation. Mr. Bradley did everything he could possibly do to evade answering questions. No recollection, couldn't remember, it was speculation. Anything he could possibly say that would cause Your Honor not to believe that Bradley knew when this relationship started. I suggest they were clear-cut lies, and the truth is in Defense Exhibit 26.
And so if we take that view, that he thoroughly impeached himself, that he did not give truthful conduct, you know, what's left standing? Generally, you would see someone who's impeached, perhaps we have some kind of core that you could point back to and say that's the time he was telling the truth. In these text messages, is it ever definitively shown how he knew this and that he actually did know it, other than just a assertion outright, absolutely? Usually, if a state has a witness that goes sideways, they've got him locked in. They've sat down with a detective and got a full statement. We don't have that here.
But what you have is a text message, which is a prior statement of Bradley that he did on his own, that was not given to him by someone else. The only thing that the court has just noted is, how do we know he wasn't speculating? Because you don't have to accept the fact that he wasn't speculating. The cases that I provided, I think, by email yesterday, the first dealing with that, you can disbelieve that testimony and draw a negative inference. That's the Ferguson case. On Lee, the other case, you can simply take the prior inconsistent statement as substantive evidence. It has the same value. And that's what I'm asking you to do, to take what was the unprompted statement in Defense Exhibit 26 of Bradley and take that on its face value, that that is an indication that Bradley in fact knew and had said he did. If you accept that, you have to have concerns about the truthfulness of Willis and Wade on the timing issue.
And I don't know if this is something maybe one of your co-counsel were going to address as well. We heard about kind of the law that applies, how we're outside kind of the orbit of the core of cases we're used to dealing with here, where it deals with side switching or where someone is in the relationship, the client relationship. The proposition you're putting forward now is that if a representative of the state, a lead prosecutor, the district attorney themselves, says something that's untruthful on the record, that is something that immediately has to be proactively policed by the trial court. Is basically what I'm getting at is, where in the law do we find the remedy to an untruthful statement? Generally, we send you down the street to the bar, right?
And that's why I gave you the cases of Registe and Edwards yesterday. While those aren't prosecutorial cases or dealing with prosecutors, they deal with counsel. And in both those cases, the trial judge found ethical violations on the part of defense counsel, or potential ethical violations, went through the ethical violations and said, based on that, you're disqualified. You cannot be the attorney of record in this case. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. If defense counsel can be kicked off of a case because of ethical violations, I suggest the same thing can happen for prosecutors when the ethical violations deal with truthfulness, candor to the court, extrajudicial statements. Those are the things that this court can rely upon and say, based on those, again, I find an appearance of impropriety.
Where would be the limiting principle? The district attorney signs every indictment assigned to this courtroom. No. Does that mean she's off every case?
No, it would be when
if I found that she's untruthful, is that what you're kind of suggesting, though?
You don't have to find, again, I'm not saying you have to find she was untruthful or that Wade was untruthful. You don't have to make a finding of fact that they lied. All you have to do is make a finding of fact that you have genuine, legitimate concerns about their credibility, about their truthfulness. And once you find that, then you can apply Registe and Edwards.
Well, but it's the same principle, though. If I have genuine concerns about her truthfulness on a particular occasion, how do those not spill over into every criminal case a district attorney brings?
Well, it's because she testified under oath, and so did Mr. Wade. They didn't have to testify falsely. They could have testified truthfully. They could have indicated that the relationship, the timing, was in fact before Mr. Wade was hired. They chose not to. And in that sense, that dishonesty, that constitutes a violation of their ethical responsibilities. This is not signing an indictment. This is not filing a pleading in which both sides have their own positions. This is a requirement that every witness has to tell the truth under oath. And if they don't tell the truth under oath, or there's a significant concern about their credibility, then they're violating their ethical rules. And as anyone will tell you, as Your Honor already knew from when you were a prosecutor, prosecutors are held to a higher standard. They're the ones that are supposed to be seeking justice. They don't have a particular, they're supposed to be disinterested. When you have the lead prosecutor and the DA giving what I suggest to you is untruthful testimony based on what Yerti has said, based on what Bradley said in his text, based on the whole way it was presented to you. Bradley didn't want to testify. He first came up with his attorney-client privilege thing on that. And Your Honor was, fortunately, went into that. And then when Bradley knew he had to testify about it, you saw what happened. You can draw the inference, as I've suggested on Bradley, that what he said in the text message, Defense Exhibit 26, is true. The relationship, in fact, started prior to November 1st of 2021. That Yerti says that. And now, without getting into any detail, the cell phone records. The cell phone records show that during that period of time from, let's say, April 1 of 2021 to November 30th of 2021, that there was a number, a considerable number, 35 or more occasions where it appeared that, based on the records, that Mr. Wade was down in the area where Ms. Willis was staying in Yerti's apartment. But more important is there are two occasions, and the state has not challenged those. There are two occasions where the records reflect that it appears Mr. Wade spent the night at that apartment. The state may say, we don't accept that, but they didn't challenge it. And even when they brought forth what they brought forth today, supplemental 2 and 3, they didn't challenge it again. So what does that suggest? That's corroborating evidence of what Yerti had said, of what Bradley said in his text message. It's also impeachment evidence as to what Wade and Willis said about how many times.
Is that a significant in terms of just the times? Didn't Mr. Wade testify that he was there at least 10 times during that time frame? You've now found 35.
Well, minimum of 35.
Okay.
But never overnight. He said he never spent overnight.
Put that to the side, though, just in terms of the fact that he did say he'd been over there, that he'd visited the place, and I would presume he wasn't obviously keeping a very good accounting of it, but that wasn't something that was entirely denied.
If you're asking me, do we win on the point that he said more than 10 or around 10 and we say 35, do we win on that point?
Sure.
No.
Okay.
It's not determined.
The overnight rate might raise some more concerns. Understood.
Yeah, it does. And that's the reason why we highlighted it in the affidavit of Mr. Mittelstadt, because that is suggestive that they were not being honest to the court. So then, how much time have I used? Have I?
I'm letting them use the hook. So, suggestive, again, raising issues. I'm wondering about burden. Is it we're dealing with a preponderance standard?
We are dealing with a preponderance standard, and it's our burden.
Yeah.
No question about that.
So does suggestive get us there?
No, but it is corroborating evidence of evidence that we did put up. And that's what the purpose of the cell phone records. They corroborate what Yerti says. They corroborate what Bradley said in Defense Exhibit 26. And they impeach, to that extent, Wade and Willis's testimony. So if you find by a preponderance of the evidence, so I can finish this up, if you find by a preponderance of the evidence that what I call subset of forensic misconduct, ethical violations, has been shown, and that there is a significant or legitimate concern about the truthfulness of Wade and Willis, they're disqualified. Now, obviously, factual findings are yours, but the law allows you to do that. You don't have to do it through an actual conflict. That's the other side of the equation. And that's what I've argued, and I think that's what Mr. Gibbons can argue.
Before I let you go, though, this is an interesting classification. You're saying forensic conduct isn't just commenting publicly about the case indicating guilt. You're saying forensic conduct is just anything a district attorney says?
No.
Falls under that box?
No. I'm saying that
improper,
that
obviously.
Forensic misconduct as a subset of that would include violations, ethical violations, which impact the ability of the defendants to get a fair trial, as well as impact the court's ability to have faith that the prosecutors, these two prosecutors, are acting in good faith in their own conduct. Same idea dealing with, as I said, defense counsel in the two cases I mentioned. Ethical violations can give rise to disqualification, and I suggest we have that here.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Sano.
Thank you.
Where's the shot clock when you need it?
Right there.
Your Honor, I want to address very directly here. What we have is a systematic, continuous pattern, a calculated plan, evidencing a design to prejudice the defendants in this case, in the minds of the jurors. This is what we have seen. This isn't the problem that the district attorney has. It's not that the district attorney had some sort of brief off-the-cuff statement in an interaction with a reporter like in Williams. That's not what we have here. We have someone who sat down, wrote out her speech, wrote out her plan, who wrote, sat down for whether it's six, two, three, or six times with the editors of Find Me the Votes and told and got her message out about this case before it was supposed to be tried in this courtroom. And so that is the problem that we have. We have a pattern of forensic misconduct on behalf of Ms. Willis.
So, I mean, we have a pattern of public statements being made. I take it you or your team has dived in and read the book. I know she was asked about specific portions in it. The only case that I can find actually talking about when someone crosses the line on public comments is that Williams case, and it talks about there has to be an implication of saying the defendant, a particular defendant, is guilty, and it even denied it, right? So have you found any case in Georgia where they actually said that a prosecutor had gone too far in their public comments? Does one exist?
Well, number one, thank goodness it doesn't happen often. Sadly, it's already happened here. Now, in Williams, the prosecutor had one response to an inquiry. The court found it was improper, but did not have this pattern. Now, it doesn't necessarily mean a comment about the quote guilt or innocence, although that was the pattern in Williams. It's the improper comments by a prosecutor. For example, in Williams, they cite the nature and consequences of forensic misconduct in prosecution of criminal case, a 1955 Columbia Law School article, and how prophetic that was. When William cites that case in that law school article, they talk about an awful lot more than simply comments about specific guilt or references to guilt. What you have here, Your Honor, is a comment, and we can't look at it it doesn't apply only if a prosecutor said, I think the defendant is guilty in my mind. No, it's more pernicious than that. What we have here is someone who sat down and drew up a plan for two reasons, and what she did reminds me of what the court in STV Texas talks about, and that is that pretrial can create major problems for a defendant, indeed more harmful than publicity during a trial, for it may set the community opinion as to guilt or innocence. That's what we have here. That's exactly what we have. And the court in Estes talks about the power of the television camera. So what do we have, and what did this prosecutor do? What she chose to do is sort of what was criticized by the Supreme Court in Shepard v. Maxwell. Legal trials are not like elections, to be won through the use of meeting halls, the radio, or the newspaper. That's exactly what we have here. What we have is a deflection. What this is all about is more insidious than just making the comments that she's made. It's a deflection. What she chose to do was to say, I have done my best to hide the relationship with Nathan Wade. And Nathan Wade has done his very best by filing false documents in his divorce case to hide his relationship with Ms. Willis. Now, and so what did they do? Well, when Ms. Merchant filed the motion to disqualify, now the game plan has to change. The game plan, I call the deflection, begins to take place. The deflection is when the district attorney sat down and wrote out. Look at I'm sure the court has. When you look at that video, it's in evidence of her speech at church. She has written out everything, and she's reading from it. She chooses to deflect. The court asked earlier, wasn't she really responding to the motion that had been filed against her? Would that she had. Because if she had, she would have looked the members of that church in the face and say, there's been an allegation that I had a romantic relationship with Mr. Wade. And ladies and gentlemen of this congregation, it's true. She didn't do that. She chose to deflect and to do two things that are reprehensible for any lawyer, but particularly for a prosecutor. She chose to pull out the race card and the God card. That's what she did. And she wrote it out. She went on to deflect away from the allegations in the Wade motion. And she said, she's saying, why, in her talk, public discussion with God, why are they only attacking one in reference to Mr. Wade? And then she goes on to say, God, isn't it them playing the race card when they only question one? Now, if she had been truthful with that congregation, truthful with the community, she would have said, I had a relationship with him. Good, bad, forgive me, whatever. That's what she should have said. But she chose to deflect and say them, the reference to them and the others and they. It's obviously a reference to the motion filed by Ms. Merchant. They choose to go after the black man. And she then goes on, again, deflecting away and deflecting to what I call the third rail in American society, choosing somebody on the other side of being a racist. So-and-so is a racist. They're racist. She was the one playing the race card in a way to try to deflect from her own conduct. She goes on to say in discussions with the Lord, God, is it that some will never see a black man as qualified, no matter his achievements? Again, the deflection. What is she saying? The listener is not necessarily in that audience in that church. The listener is at Fulton County. The potential jurors who will come into a courtroom and say whether or not they can fairly judge the evidence or judge the defense in this case. She chose to inject race into the minds of the listeners and virtually everybody in this community and literally everybody in this country has reviewed and analyzed her speech that she made in a premeditated way. And in bringing in not only the race card, but also in bringing in the religious matter, this is exactly what Hammons v. State and our Supreme Court talks about condemning as an inflammatory appeal to the juror's private religious beliefs. Why would she do that? To deflect. But now, not only is she deflecting, but she is then going forward and, in a way, telling the community, telling the congregation that God is on her side, not on the side of these people. God, she said, and when she's talking, and she's saying, God's saying, pray for their souls. I, meaning God, qualified you. I qualified your imperfect, flawed self. I see you in every hour. Do my work. As though she's telling the folks in her very, very, very implicit way, injecting into the minds of the jurors, God wants me to win this case. God wants me to prosecute this case. And why is he going, and why are these others going after the black man? Well, the answer is very simple. As we said in our brief, we didn't mention Mrs. Cross, the white female, or Mr. Floyd, the white male, because there was absolutely no evidence and is no evidence of a personal romantic relationship with them in which she obtained these benefits. That's the reason why we did not do that. So she goes forward with her with the deflections, that's exactly what she does when she goes forward and she talks about a planned interviews time and time again with authors of a book, Find Me the Votes, where she's talking about a case that's going to be tried in this courtroom. It's reprehensible.
So in that specific, excuse me, instance, setting aside the fact that she was willing to go on the record before a case had even reached the jury, what specific statements from that book do you contend cross the line?
Well, for example, she's saying, she goes on to talk about all the calls that she gets from people calling her racial terms. All the calls are racist. What she's trying to do, and I think there's a reference in there to MAGA people, whatever. In that, what she's really saying is that those people calling me up and making those claims or those horrible racial slurs to me are really people on their side of the fence. That's what she's doing. And there's no reason, Your Honor, ever for a prosecutor to sit down and go forward with this kind of interview. She did it in Find the Votes. But then what really happened here is this hiding of the relationship. Because in hiding the relationship, they have done such a good job. Mr. Wade filed false documents in his divorce case on May the 23rd, May of 2023, talking about, have you ever had sexual relations with a person during the course of the marriage or including the period of separation? He's still married. He doesn't have a divorce decree, but his answer is none. Then he's asked whether or not on any occasions he's entertained or been entertained by someone, a woman, a member of the opposite sex, in this case a woman, from the date of the marriage to the present, talking about place and time and all that. What is the answer? None. Why does he do that? He does that because he doesn't want to tell about the relationship that he has with Miss Willis and the benefits that he has gotten and that he gave to her. And what these answers are absolutely reprehensible, that a member of the State Bar of Georgia would file these answers that are inaccurate. What does Miss Wade do? Miss Willis do? Miss Willis, on her financial report, on whether or not she has gotten anything of $100 or more in value from a prohibited source. The court asked earlier about what a threshold might be. Well, if for the financial report, it's $100. That's it. She doesn't report any of all of the benefits that she received from Mr. Wade, all the trips, all the entertainment, all the three nights in the luxury suite in Aruba, all of that. None of that is here. And they say, oh, well, maybe it all balanced out, even though I can't prove it with the cash. Well, that's like saying, did I give the court a Christmas present? Well, maybe I gave the court a Christmas present, and the court gave me one back. If the court has to fill out a form whether you got a Christmas present from anybody, you say I got one from Mr. Gillen. You don't say, nah, well, I gave him one back, so it really evens out. They're false reports. And because they're false, what they had to do is they had to say, uh-oh, Miss Merchant has caught us. And so what we're going to do is we're going to get, in our response, we're going to get Mr. Wade to file a false declaration, which he does. His declaration in this case is false. And the evidence showing that that is false as it relates to the timing, and the court asked earlier, why does it matter, if the relationship was before or after November 1, 2021? The answer is they think it's important, and frankly, I do too. Because when she's hiring somebody and she's not telling the people who are going to be paying the tab up to $700,000, hey, I just hired my boyfriend who's taking me on a trip to the Caribbean and taking me down to Aruba and taking me to California. Hope you don't mind. No disclosure whatsoever. And the money flows off. But because they got caught, they then commit what I think is an additional component of forensic misconduct, and that is fraud on this court. When they file that affidavit, and now it's been proven, I think, beyond virtually any doubt that the relationship occurred prior to November
2021, and the benefits that were there. And we don't have to run around. And I love we've got all the records showing from Mr. Wade about the payment for these trips, for the cruises, for the flights, all this stuff. What's the only way is they sat around and met together before they testified and came up with their story. What's the only way that they can save themselves? Pay no attention to the records. Pay no attention to the airlines and to the flights and the vacations and the cruises. I paid him back in cash. Show us your receipts. Where did you take cash out of the bank? Ever? Oh, I don't have any. Well, show us the deposits that he had. Well, never. We don't have any. What we have here is a fraud on this court, which has been shown, I think, overwhelmingly by the evidence, and overwhelmingly through not only the testimony of Urdy, the testimony of the emails and the text from Mr. Bradley to Ms. Merchant, as well as all the documents that they had no answer to other than the "just trust me, I gave him money, it evaporated, I don't know where it came from, and he doesn't know what he did with it. Just please trust us and believe us, because it's our only way out of the trap that they set for themselves." These people, sadly, and I hate to say, as the court knows, I was a prosecutor for about 3.5 million years, it seems, in the federal building, and I was an assistant DA beforehand. Prosecutors don't act like this. Lawyers don't act like this. These people, Your Honor, is a systematic misconduct, and they need to go. Thank you.
Your Honor, I'm going to cover a few factual details without overly rehashing what has already been said. During the pendency of this investigation in this case, Mr. Wade and Ms. Willis basically lived Robin Leach's lifestyle of the rich and famous. And they did this riding on the backs of the defendants in this case, funded by the taxpayers of Fulton County and the state of Georgia, with the money that was paid to Mr. Wade through the contract that Ms. Willis got him. That money flow, that is the personal interest that you asked about. She was personally benefiting from the position, from the job, from the scope of the investigation, from the scope of the indictment, and how they conducted it. And we know this. We know from the records that have been submitted before the court that Mr. Wade paid at least $17,095 towards this relationship. That does not even include the various dinners, the day trips that both Wade and Willis admitted to. So that number is likely even higher. We know from the documents that Ms. Willis only paid $1,394 for an airline ticket. We know from Ms. Urdy, who was pretty much uncontested, there was no evidence presented by the state disputing her time frame, that that relationship started in 2019. She saw them kissing, she saw them hugging. Now, whether or not they had sex before January of 2022, I do not know. They admitted sometime in early 2022, and I found it curious that they both, Wade and Willis, just went straight to the sex. So maybe that's when they started having sex. I do not know. But the relationship predated that. And their combined and overly suggestive focus on that is a red herring to this court and to the defense, that that's what they want you to focus on. They want you to ignore all the evidence that the relationship predated that. The relationship started in 2019. The relationship continued through 2020. The relationship continued through 2021. Looking at the cell phone communications, just in the first 11 months of 2021, over 2,000 calls, almost 9,800 texts. You know, I don't even think love-struck teenagers communicate that much. The November 29th and November 30th escapade, phone call from Ms. Willis, between Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade, 11:32 that night. Shortly after midnight, the phone starts traveling down from where Mr. Wade lives and ends up where Ms. Willis is staying, and he's there until roughly 4:55 a.m. None of the excuses, none of the explanations that Mr. Wade gave go into the Porsche experience, go into dinner, go into the airport. None of that explains that. I'm pretty sure the Porsche experience isn't open in the middle of the night. I'm pretty sure that there weren't any restaurants that he drove 30 to 45 minutes to go eat at in the middle of the night right after he talked to Ms. Willis. Teenagers have a name for those kind of calls and those kind of escapades. I won't go into it. But the documentary evidence, the objective evidence, undercuts everything that both Wade and Willis said. When you look at Ms. Yurdie, again, she unequivocally said that relationship began in 2019. She saw physical evidence of a romantic relationship. Mr. Bradley, in the text messages, which are substantive evidence, said that that relationship began in 2019. Again, his January, temporary amnesia that somehow was triggered temporarily after Gabe Banks called him, we can question that. But we do have statements from him that specifically said that relationship predated Mr. Wade's appointment by Ms. Willis. You asked what the materiality would be. How much is enough? Well, clearly 17,000 is enough. But Fulton County has told Mrs. Willis what the materiality is. It's $100 in a year. She twice signed declarations, certifications that she did not receive any gifts. And even under her strained explanation, there were monies, there were gifts, there were dinners, there were excess contributions flowing her way that exceeded $100. Her explanation, well, I just paid it in cash. That just does not stand to reason. It does not hold up to the light of truth. Anyone that has ever been in a money laundering trial, a forfeiture trial, if that's the explanation we give the state, they laugh. Oh, I just gave cash. I have no records for it. I have no source for it. The only thing that she could say that was a source for the money, because at times she said she was down to $500 to $1,000. The only explanation she had is, well, sometimes I go to Publix and I may get an extra $50. That shows up on your debit card or your credit card. Did they bring those records in? No. Did they bring her bank accounts in? No. Did they bring any documentary evidence in? No, they did not. And why is that important, Judge? Yes, the burden is ours. But under OCGA 24-14-22, if a party has evidence in such party's power and within such party's reach, by which he or she may repel a claim, and they had that power, Ms. Willis had that power, Mr. Wade had that power, that they can repel the claim that we have made against them, but they omit to produce it, or if they produce weaker evidence, then you, as the fact finder, Judge, it is in your power to disregard that, and a presumption arises that that documentary evidence that is in their possession that they failed to produce supports our claim. And that is something that the state relies on regularly in criminal trials. And that is something that the court should rely on in this case when formulating its factual findings. And we know that both Mr. Wade and Ms. Willis have some difficulty expressing the truth when it comes to their relationship in these cases. We know Mr. Wade lied in his interrogatories multiple times. We know Ms. Willis falsely certified that she hadn't received any gifts from anybody. And Mr. Wade clearly was a prohibited source. He was someone doing business with Fulton County. Anything over $100 in a year, she had to put down, and she put zero. And it defies imagination that she could somehow forget about all these trips, all these dinners, all these day trips, and not put that money down. You had asked, I think it was Mr. Gillen, did she say in that church speech or anywhere else that the defendants were guilty? And I think she did in that church speech. She said in that church speech, and she was talking about a conversation that she apparently had with God, talking about herself. She said, this leader has a trial conviction rate of 95%. She said, the trial team this leader put together has a conviction rate of 95%. I do not see how anyone, and I think that was purposefully intended by Ms. Willis, I do not see how anyone can listen to those two statements and not take that Ms. Willis is telling everyone in that church and everyone that's going to hear that in the media afterwards that these defendants are guilty. That is what she was saying. She is a prosecutor. She's familiar with the U.S. v. Berger. Every single attorney that's ever been a prosecutor is familiar with the dictates of that U.S. Supreme Court case. That is a foul blow. That is improper, and she violated pretty much every tenet a prosecutor must abide by to seek truth and justice in a particular case. So, Judge, when you're looking at this, the uncontroverted evidence shows that they had a relationship prior. The uncontroverted evidence shows that Mr. Wade lavishly spent on Ms. Willis. The uncontroverted evidence shows that the money that he was spending on Ms. Willis came from this contract that he had. And I'm not just talking about the contract as a special prosecutor, but there's also those other questionable contracts that no matter whom his partner seemed to be, they also got. There is a direct financial benefit that Ms. Willis received from this. And Judge, looking back at what Judge McBurney said, if merely hosting a fundraiser for a political opponent of a putative defendant creates not only the appearance but an actual conflict, then what Ms. Willis has done since then in this case creates an actual conflict. But again, as prior counsel has stated, we only need to show the appearance of a conflict. And we have done that by a preponderance of the evidence. In fact, I believe we've shown an actual conflict. But nonetheless, the result should be that Ms. Willis and her office should be disqualified from this case. We still have a few more minutes. I think Mr. Cromwell may have something to say. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
Yeah.
Harry MacDougall for Mr. Clark. I'm going to talk further about conflicts, and I'm going to assume the most difficult standard for us to meet, which is actual conflict. But before I begin that, I want to add just a little bit to what has already been said about the standards that apply to prosecutors. Our appellate courts have said often, the administration of the law, and especially that of the criminal law, should, like Caesar's wife, be above suspicion and should be free from all temptation, bias, or prejudice so far as it is possible for our courts to accomplish it. The first occurrence of that I can find is Nichols v. State more than 100 years ago, 1915. The most recent, Regista v. State in the Supreme Court in 2010, although they don't refer to Caesar's wife. That requirement is also embedded in the prosecutor's statutory oath, 15-18-2, which requires impartially and without fear or favor discharge my duties as district attorney and take only my lawful compensation, so help me God. The general rule on conflicts of interest for lawyers is in Rule of Professional Conduct 1.7. And we all know, it's all drummed into us, that we cannot have a conflict of interest. And if we do, we have to withdraw or we will be disqualified. The basic idea is that a conflict of interest impairs the lawyer's independent professional judgment. That's the test of a conflict and whether it can be waived and whether it's disqualifying. And that conflict is not just financial. It can be any conflict that impairs your independent professional judgment, and you see that in McLaughlin v. Payne. The court asked what was a personal interest for purposes of disqualification. It's anything that impairs professional judgment. That's reflected in the ABA standards that were quoted by Mr. Merchant, which list the prosecutor's personal, political, financial, professional, business, property, or other interests or relationships. And that's really embedded in the prosecutor's oath to act impartially. And the earlier disqualification order by Judge McBurney was based on political interests, not financial. What my colleagues have described as forensic misconduct is also cognizable as a conflict of interest based on that footnote in the Williams case. The root of all of the problems that we see in this court right now is a conflict of interest arising from their individual personal interests in perpetuating and concealing their relationship. That's the original sin from which all of the other problems flow. There are six different actual conflicts of interest in this case, any one of which warrants disqualification, but collectively, practically compelling. First, the financial conflict that's already been covered. Second, the personal ambition, political ambition. Third, there's a dovetailed or complementary pattern of deceit and concealment of the relationship and the money. Fourth, the speech at the church. Fifth, the motion for protective order that the DA filed in Mr. Wade's divorce case. Sixth, the way the state has conducted the defense of this motion to disqualify, especially the hearing. On the financial piece, the court asked for a limiting principle and asked about materiality. The limiting principle is whatever impairs the independent professional judgment of the lawyer. That is applied routinely. We have a county code section that flatly prohibits gifts from contractors, period. We have, by analogy, the federal bribery statute, which has a threshold of $5,000, 18 U.S.C. 666. The court asked about burdens and inferences. The court can draw a negative inference from the state's failure to produce evidence to support the invisible magic cash balancing theory based on State v. Thomas, 311 Georgia, 407, particularly footnote 19. As to the timing question that the court asked about, there were two contracts for Mr. Wade executed after they acknowledged the relationship began. Each one of them afflicted or conflicted under county and common law. The second conflict is her political ambition, for which he was previously chastised by Judge McBurney. And that's also present in this book. The inside flap of this book says that they were given, quote, exclusive access to thousands of secret documents, emails, text messages, and audio recordings. The court has twice denied defense motions to unseal special purpose grand jury materials. She helped herself to get the glory of this book. I introduced certified copies of a number of county code sections. I'm not going to walk through those, but I'll tell you why they matter. The stack of law from the state constitution down to the county ordinances imposes a regime on the DA under which she has three obligations. She has to go to the county commission to get approval to pay him like she did. She cannot accept gifts from a prohibited source. She has to disclose the gifts that she received. She evaded all of those requirements. Section 2-69 of the county code prohibits gifts from prohibited sources, which he was. There's no boyfriend exception. The disclosure forms The evidence is sufficient for you to find that her disclosure form for 2022 is false and that it is a false writing. That's an actual conflict of interest between her duty, legal duty of disclosure, her legal duty of candor as a prosecutor, and her private and personal interests in concealing the relationship, concealing the gifts, and keeping the gravy train rolling for as long as possible. His part in the pattern of concealment is a story you see in many divorce cases. The husband is hiding things from his wife. How much money he's making, the other woman, and what he's spending on the other woman. And he got on that stand, lied in his interrogatories, and he got on the stand and he lied about lying in the interrogatories. And the lawyers for the DA, the DA's office, they just sat there and let him do it. They did nothing to correct obviously perjured testimony. In and of itself, that warrants disqualification of every one of them. The reason they lied and covered it up was to avoid the trouble they're in right now. That served their personal interests to the detriment of their public duties as prosecutors. The speech at the church, I want to focus on why she did that. Mr. Gillen talked about that. She did it to deflect attention from her own misconduct and that of Mr. Wade. She violated her public duty as a prosecutor to serve her personal interests and the personal interests of her boyfriend. That is a disqualifying conflict between her personal interests and her public duty that is actual, operational, and materialized, and it rests on undisputed facts. The next thing that she did that was a disqualifying conflict of interest was the emergency motion for protective order that she filed in the divorce. I filed a certified copy of that as Exhibit 37. She sought a protective order under the Apex Doctrine on the grounds that she's the DA. And the whole filing is expressly predicated on her status as DA. In fact, she never lets you forget it. She says it 27 times in 12 pages. In that filing, speaking as DA, she said, the circumstances, quote, suggest that defendant Joycelyn Wade is using the legal process to harass and embarrass District Attorney Willis, and in doing so is obstructing and interfering with an ongoing criminal investigation. In the prayer for relief on page 11, she asked for 6 months to, quote, complete a review of the filings in the instant case, investigate and depose relevant witnesses with regard to the interference and obstruction this motion contends. There's no sugarcoating it. That's a clear violation of Rule of Professional Conduct 3.4H, which prohibits lawyers from making threats of criminal prosecution to gain advantage in a civil case. She abused her power. She abused her position to threaten her boyfriend's wife with criminal prosecution to gain advantage for herself and her boyfriend in her boyfriend's divorce. She violated her public duties not to make that kind of a threat in order to serve her private personal interests and those of Mr. Wade. Another actual operational conflict. The last category is the conduct of the defense of this hearing. There were a lot of objections made based on attorney-client privilege during Mr. Bradley's testimony. Most of those objections were made by the state. But the privilege being asserted does not belong to the state. It belongs to Mr. Wade. That shows that the DA's office is serving the personal interests of the DA and Mr. Wade in carrying out further concealment and cover-up of their relationship, and not the cause of justice they are sworn to serve. That is a conflict of interest. It's a continuation of the wrongful pattern of concealment and cover-up that they've engaged in since the beginning. But now they've enlisted the entire office in the enterprise. In the written response to the motion to disqualify, they said this, and I quote, "To be absolutely clear, there is no evidence that D.A. Willis derived any financial benefit from Mr. Wade." That's on page 15. Flat out false. 10 lawyers in this case put their name on that, starting with the D.A. So throw another log on the bonfire of conflicts of interest. The problem here is the DA cannot distinguish between her personal interests and ambitions on the one hand and her public duties as a prosecutor on the other, and apparently neither can anyone else in their office. Of the 6 conflicts I've identified, only one is subject to a conflict in the evidence. This is a case study in what happens when you operate under a conflict of interest. It's put an irreparable stain on the case. Think of the message that would be sent if they were not disqualified. If this is tolerated, we'll get more of it. This office is a global laughingstock because of their conduct. They should be disqualified and the case should be dismissed.
Your Honor, there's not much oxygen left in the room. We delineated the times based on the whole presentation. Would Your Honor consider some time for us in rebuttal?
No.
Okay, well then, could I reserve what I had 5 minutes for
sure,
rebuttal?
Sure, that's fine.
All right, thank you, Your Honor.
All right, let's take a quick 5, and we'll be back at 2:40-ish to be here from the state. Thank you.
Thank you.
or no?
Back on the record. Stay ready.
Yes, Judge. I just am trying to get to where I can share my screen.
We need to add you as a host, then. What's your profile name on the Zoom? Your screen name on the Zoom?
Adam Abadi.
All right, just making sure. Bear with us. Do you need it right away?
No, I can start without.
All right, floor is yours.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. I want to start with some of the things that were addressed over the last hour and a half. First, beginning with something Mr. Merchant referenced as it related to the comments that the state made in regards to the good faith basis in which was submitted to the court, in which defense counsel claimed the evidence would show. And I would strongly bring to the court's attention that the claims that were made were material misrepresentations. And what I will tell to, or what I will say to the court, and why I say that to the court, is because the representations that were made by counsel was that Ms. Daisha Young, Ms. Sonia Allen, Mr. Dexter Bonds, Investigator Hill, Investigator Green, Investigator Ricks, all of these people would be called, and Mr. Bradley would be able to impeach their knowledge by saying that he specifically, in his presence, or to him, said that Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade were in a romantic relationship, and that Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade were cohabitating, that they all knew that. And I would submit to the court, we didn't hear from any of those individuals. Mr. Bradley impeached no one. And I say no one because he did not impeach Mr. Wade. In order to properly impeach a witness, you have to confront the witness with the specific statements. Mr. Wade, and you can look back at the YouTube of the entire hearings of the last couple days, Mr. Wade wasn't once confronted with a statement that he claimed or said, or that is claimed that he said to Mr. Bradley. The way you properly impeach somebody, you have to confront the witness. Here would be Mr. Wade, and once he makes a statement that you believe to be inconsistent, and you have a witness who can prove that inconsistency, that's when you call that witness. And when Mr. Wade was on the stand, not once was he asked, did you tell Mr. Bradley this in a confidential conversation in your conference room that was not covered under attorney-client privilege? That was not asked. The specifics of that conversation was not asked. So any testimony that Mr. Bradley testified to is impermissible. It is improper impeachment because they did not confront Mr. Wade with it. So that's where the state would begin with the comments that Mr. Merchant made about me referencing his wife as lying. I never called Ms. Merchant a liar. I never used those words. I don't know why she made the material misrepresentations. It could be because Mr. Bradley lied to her. I don't know the reason. So, but I can submit to the court that those were material misrepresentations that were made to this court on the day a few Mondays ago, as everyone was arguing the motions to quash certain subpoenas. I'd also bring to the court's attention that during that motion to quash subpoenas, certain subpoenas, Ms. Yurdie's attorney appeared, Mr. Partridge, and he made very clear on that Zoom that Ms. Yurdie had absolutely no knowledge of a romantic relationship and absolutely no knowledge of cohabitation. Those were the specific references that he made. So what I would submit to the court is those are considered adoptive omissions that his client has made based on the statements he made because of the representations she made to him. So, and I know that sounds convoluted, but what I would say to the court is Ms. Yurdie told Mr. Partridge, because Mr. Partridge told the court that she had absolutely no information about a romantic relationship, and she had absolutely no information as in regards to...
So, but wait, are you making an argument I should make inferences based... Now, these would be attorney-client privileges, or communications then. She's communicating with Mr. Partridge about what her upcoming testimony is. That's why she's hired him. And you're telling me I should infer things based on her communications to him?
Absolutely, because they're not attorney-client communications anymore when he discloses them to the court and everybody else as they watch the Zoom and attend the hearing. The difference is there was no request to go in camera. There was no request to go or to have a private conversation with you as was done with Mr. Bradley. That would have been the proper procedure. So, yes, I'm asking you to infer that 100%. I'm asking you to infer that her testimony was at best inconsistent. Because the testimony of Ms. Yurdie, when she testified, was vague, very little description. When asked in a very leading manner, is it true or do you know that Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade were in a relationship from 2019 into the time you were fired for, or excuse me, you were forced to resign from the district attorney's office in March of 2022? She said yes. And then further, when pressed by Mr. Sadow, he talks about why she believed they were in a relationship. And what was interesting from Ms. Yurdie's testimony that they were pretty close friends up until she left the DA's office, that she asserted to the court that on a yearly basis, Ms. Willis said, I'm in a relationship with Mr. Wade in 2019. Oh, by the way, I want to tell you again in 2020, because we're in a new year, I'm still in a relationship with Mr. Wade. And again, in 2021, the assertion is Ms. Willis then went back to Ms. Yurdie and confirmed, hey, I just want to reconfirm me and Mr. Wade are still in a relationship. It's absurd. It's absolutely absurd. More importantly, when Mr. Sadow asked her about why she believed that they were in a romantic relationship based on her own observations, she said something. He said, he actually asked her, did you see him kissing or hugging? She said yes, but there was no description or qualification about when it occurred, what she actually saw, was it a kiss on the cheek, things of that nature. So I would ask you to frame her testimony from that standpoint when you're addressing her credibility, as the court is going to do with each and every witness that you heard during the testimony of all the witnesses during the hearing. I'm going to see if my screen will share. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the standard and the burden here in this instance as it relates to defense counsel and the claims that they have made in the motion to disqualify. And as I was doing a whole lot of research, I came upon this law review article from Cornell scholarship reading or publication, and they made very clear that courts have been relatively reluctant to exercise their power to disqualify prosecutors for any reason. And that goes along with the standard what the state would submit to the court, is that the defense has to show an actual conflict. And in this instance, they have to show the actual conflict would be that Ms. Willis received a financial benefit or gain and did it based or got it based upon the outcome of the case. It doesn't make any sense. It makes absolutely no sense. And during the 3 days of the extensive testimony of all of the witnesses and the prolonged examinations of the witnesses by multiple the defense counsel, they still got nowhere. We're in the same position we were in on Monday. The same assertions that were made on Monday have no answers today as we're before Your Honor. They were not able to provide any evidence as to, or to the contrary, of Ms. Willis and Ms. Wade's assertions of when their relationship began. There's absolutely no evidence that contradicts that the relationship did not begin later than or around March of 2022, Your Honor. I'd further submit to the court, because of this failure, that their assertion or their request that, one, the indictment be dismissed. There's absolutely no evidence that the defendants in this case, their due process rights, have been harmed in absolutely any way. There was zero evidence. Not a single shred of evidence was produced through any of the exhibits or the witness testimony showing how their constitutional rights, their due process rights, were at all affected by the relationship that began in March of 2022 with Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade. And because of that, the motion to disqualify should be denied, and Ms. Willis, as the district attorney of Fulton County, and Mr. Wade, as the special prosecutor assigned to this case, should be allowed to remain on this case and continue to prosecute the case to the end, Your Honor, until the trial is set by the court and is to begin. Now, the issues, obviously, you've heard a lot from defense counsel as to what the issues are for you to, determine. And here it would be the state's contention is that you must find that there's an actual conflict if you were or are to come to the conclusion that you should disqualify Ms. Willis and the district attorney's office. And in looking at
I think you're talking about Mrs. Ventura.
It's McGlynn v. State, McGlynn v. State, 342 Georgia Appeal, 170. It's a 2017 case. In that case, it talks about the standard of proof that the defense, or the burden that the defense must show and go to show an actual conflict, is they say it's a high standard of proof, which is definitely not a preponderance of the evidence, which is a much lower burden for any party who's trying to meet that standard of preponderance. But it's clear that the standard is that is a high standard of proof for both when determining whether there's an actual conflict and when there's forensic misconduct that is found, Your Honor. And I want to go through some of the cases that defense counsel has referenced as they argued here today and in their filings. And I guess the bright line standard or the standard and the grounds for which disqualification is appropriate for Your Honor to be determining in all of the cases as it relates to disqualifying the elected district attorney is that you either find that there's a conflict of interest or that there's been some sort of forensic misconduct. Those are, I guess, the two areas that Your Honor that is in your purview when you are looking to resolve an issue regarding disqualification. Now, in a recent case, Lee v. State, which is 224 Georgia, Lexus 31. It's a February of 2024 case here out of our appellate courts. And in that case, Justice Pinson wrote that a trial court did not abuse its discretion by failing to disqualify an assistant district attorney absent an actual conflict of interest. And that is a case that was ruled on by the Georgia Court of Appeals about a month ago, Your Honor. Now, the cases in which defense counsel have relied on in their briefs and here today, I would submit to the court the cites are misleading, are inapplicable, and some of them actually support the state's position. And what I would say to you is that the defendants, in many instances, combine language from the multiple cases and kind of what I would say is misstates the law as it relates to what the law or what is required in order for an elected district attorney and their office to be disqualified. And what I would submit to the court
is... Let's go back to that. Show me how.
Yes. Show you how.
So I think the first one they cited was battle versus the state. Certainly yes. A conflict of interest or the appearance of impropriety can be the grounds of disqualification.
Well.
There are a number of these cases that seem to exclusively rely on the appearance of impropriety.
Right.
Well, they acknowledge that there's some ambiguity here, that sometimes Whitworth gets cited to Ventura, and we've got this quote that comes up where it's just they only cite to an actual conflict that must be involved. But they acknowledge the ambiguity. You're saying there's no ambiguity whatsoever.
I am saying that, and why I am saying that, why I would submit that to the court, is in all of those cases, they do reference the appearance of an impropriety, but they reference that because they also find there's an actual conflict in each one of those cases.
So your position would be your review of the case law, there's never been an appellate opinion that relied only on an appearance of a propriety.
As it relates to a prosecutor or a district attorney, yes, that is what I'm saying. What I would say is in those cases, they do reference the fact that there is an appearance of impropriety, but they reference that fact because when you have an actual conflict, there's always an appearance of impropriety. And those are what those cases stand for. And though, I guess that is the main example of what I reference as they kind of combine the language from separate and different cases and tell you that the standard is an appearance of impropriety. And I would submit to the court that is not the standard. And in my first reading, like Your Honor, I did notice that the cases each reference the appearance of impropriety, but also that appearance arose from the fact that the court found an actual conflict in each one of those cases. So I won't belabor the point in going through all of the cases that the defense had cited, but what I would submit to the court in reading those cases is that I found that they kind of fell into five categories, that some that didn't concern disqualification at all, some that determined or that were about, I call it divided loyalty, which is a conflict that arises from representing becoming a prosecutor and then having represented the defendant prior to becoming a prosecutor, and then whether there's an actual personal interest in the outcome, and then others talk about whether the defendant was denied a fundamentally fair trial at the conclusion of the case after conviction. And these are some of the cases that defense counsel had cited within their brief that had absolutely no application to the issue that we're here before Your Honor today. The first, McIver v. State, has nothing to do has nothing related to the disqualification of anyone.
I mean, I think some of these are just relating to kind of aspiring for broad language about standards to prosecutors. So point taken there. But if there are more... All right, keep going.
So as it relates to one of the cases that was referenced here earlier and is also referenced in some of the briefing by defense counsel is the Regesti v. State, which is 287 Georgia 542, and all of the cases that fall under this, what I would call category, is about an attorney who formally prosecuted a defendant in, I guess, the same type of case or the same case or similar charges. And that would be why the courts found that disqualification would be necessary because of the relationship that existed between the former client and the now person who's being prosecuted, Your Honor. The next series of slides just goes through what has been addressed as it relates to the standard that is required when dealing with the issue of disqualification, and the state would contend and submit to the court that the defense must show an actual conflict in order to have the district attorney disqualified, and that actual conflict has to be in the form of showing that Ms. Willis, in this instance, received a financial benefit or gain in relation to the outcome of the case. Unlike many of the cases that involve personal interest, Your Honor, it's all based on a contingency fee, where how much they're paid, or a bonus, for example, is dependent on upon the outcome of the case. That's how one is to show that there's a personal interest in the case. We have none of that here. And I would submit to the court, we have absolutely no evidence that Ms. Willis received any financial gain or benefit. The testimony was that Ms. Willis paid all of the money back in cash as related to the trips, and if didn't pay back in cash, it was
all right. Let me explore this one a little bit. Mm-hmm. So, in addition to, you know, you're saying it's only an actual conflict, are you also saying that it's only if a financial interest is affecting the final result, the outcome? That's the only one we should be worried about? Or is it that the prosecution as a whole is what we should be looking at in terms of a stake? So what I'm thinking of, I'm just going to try and come up with some hypos here. What if ADAs are given a bonus for every motion to suppress they win, $1,000 per Fourth Amendment claim they win? Well, now they've got an incentive, if one of their officers is lying, not to tell you about it, because they want to win that motion to suppress. But maybe that doesn't affect the outcome, because you can win a motion to suppress or lose it, and that doesn't decide whether, you know, it's going to be a guilty or not guilty verdict. But doesn't that affect the prosecution of the case, if not the outcome?
Yes, I would definitely agree that that would be an instance where disqualification would be necessary and appropriate, because it's a situation that involves a contingency fee, and I would submit to the court that it actually does end up affecting.
It could, based on how important the motion to suppress is, right? Right. But if it's some immaterial, you know, I don't know. But I guess, so you're saying it's maybe not so much just the whether it's a guilty or not guilty dismissal, no process at the end of the day. It is actually the conduct of the prosecution that should be looked at throughout the course of the prosecution.
Correct, as it relates to how it affects the prosecution, which I would submit the court ultimately is going to affect the end outcome of the case. If you have a contingency fee based on winning, or how, you know, if you win a motion to suppress, and it's, can, you know, if you win, you get, you know, a bonus, as Your Honor referenced. I think that is ultimately going to affect the end outcome of the case, because, as Your Honor just said, if there's an instance where an officer's lying, or that where there isn't a good faith to go forward with that motion, the prosecutor would go for it with regardless, because of the contingency fee, which not only affects the prosecution at that point of the proceedings, but ultimately is going to affect the entire case, because if they were to win a motion to suppress, or I guess the motion would be denied and the evidence wasn't suppressed, knowing that they didn't have a good faith basis to go forward affects the ultimate outcome of the case. So I think it's twofold, as Your Honor has referenced. I think it's at that part of the, I guess, the procedure of the proceedings would definitely qualify for a reason necessary to disqualify a prosecuting agency. But ultimately, that action during the procedure will lead to the ultimate outcome of the case being or hinging upon a contingency fee like the ones in the cases referenced by counsel and the state that are on the screen.
So getting into the language again, which you just had up there with greater amusements, mm-hmm. and amusement sales, greater amusements is one of those. You refer to the appearance of conflict as dicta. Why do you think that's dicta? I think the quote from that one is, it guarantees at least the appearance of a conflict of interest. Why is that dicta? It seems very central to the holding in the case.
Because I don't disagree with Your Honor, but in that case, an actual conflict was found, and the appearance...
They didn't find that.
I would disagree with you, Your Honor. I would... My reading of the case is that an actual conflict was found, but because of that actual conflict, an appearance of impropriety was seen. And that's the reference, or why the state referenced that case in relation to the argument that an actual conflict is required. In the series of cases, Young, that was referenced by defense counsel, as well as Nichols of the state, are both instances where there's a personal interest in the case due to the situation and where at one point they were opposing parties. And of course, there's a personal interest or stake as it relates to prosecuting an opposing party in a civil claim, which are what both of those cases reference, which shows that there's an actual conflict of interest that relates to the personal gain of the specific prosecuting agency.
And what do you make of Nichols' reference to, you know, it's an older case, sometimes the language can be what we're not accustomed to seeing, but there's, you know, they refer to the metaphor of Caesar's wife, and generally when that's used as a ethical standard, that's something that goes beyond just an actual conflict, right? Isn't the beyond reproach getting more into appearance world?
Is it getting beyond?
No, isn't getting into the appearance aspect of things when we're talking about Caesar's wife?
But I think it goes beyond that based on the language of the holding in that case, where it literally says that the individual had a personal interest in obtaining a fee by forcing a settlement in the civil case and using the criminal case as leverage. So that's not an appearance of impropriety. That is an actual conflict of interest in which arises because of the individual's personal stake in the end outcome of the case, Your Honor. So that's how I would differentiate, I guess, the representations of defense counsel as it relates to the standard or the burden that must be shown and why the state would submit to the court, and the most recent ruling out of the Georgia appellate courts that an actual conflict is required to be shown. So I'm going to skip through these series of slides. We've heard all about Whitworth. So I go back to what we referenced earlier, what's been referenced by all parties, that the grounds in which a district attorney can be disqualified is where a conflict of interest is found, and where there's forensic misconduct that is found. Those are the two grounds that are to be, I guess, are within the purview of the court as it relates to the issues here. And again, I go back to the most recent case that was Justice Pinson wrote about, and that it there must be that by failing to disqualify the assistant district attorney, absent an actual conflict of interest. I think the language there is very clear, and I think it's very controlling, and I think it's purposeful, I would submit to the court, because an actual conflict of interest is what is required in order for a district attorney to be disqualified, because the cases make very clear, and through the precedent relating to this issue, that a disqualification of a district attorney is the last, for a lack of better words, ditch effort that should be exercised as it relates to the court in curing certain conflicts that may arise. I think the case law is very clear that every effort is supposed to be made in lieu of disqualifying the district attorney unless an actual conflict of interest is what's found, Your Honor, and it can't be cured. So what I would reference to the court, as was brought up earlier in Lyons v. State, 271 Georgia 639, a 1999 case where it talks about a theoretical or speculative conflict will not impugn a conviction, meaning that speculation, conjecture, things of that nature, assumptions are not enough for anything to arise to an actual conflict. And what I would submit to the court as well, that goes to the fact that what has to be shown is an actual conflict. If it's speculation.
Is there any qualifier there, though, that's in a post-conviction context?
So
we're talking about, you know, competent evidence. We're obviously in a pretrial phase here. I've wondered how much import to give that sentence when we're in a pretrial realm. That's assessing whether to overturn a conviction, and usually that's kind of an entirely different standard where we assess as a totality, was there a fair trial? Is there harmless error? I know there's no harmless error when it comes to disqualifications, but just a thought, if you have any reactions.
Well, I think what Your Honor just said is pretty on point, in the sense that it's found that if the trial court either applied the wrong standard or should have disqualified the district attorney, it leads to an automatic reversal, like you said, and it goes back to the trial court. And I think that is very enlightening, in the sense that that's only done if an actual conflict is shown, and the fact that it can't just be theoretical, speculative, or assumptions that would lead to the appearance of impropriety, the appearance of a conflict that would lead to
I'm borrowing kind of from, as we've been doing in the other pretrial motion, special demurrers seem to get different treatment pretrial and post-trial. Post-trial, they get more of a pass unless you can show some issues, and I'm wondering if that same principle applies here with disqualification.
But
I don't have the answer to that.
Well, what I would also say, and I don't remember the exact line, but I know there in Judge McBurney's order, he does address some of the concerns that as it relates to the standard as it's applied post-conviction versus pretrial, during pretrial issues. And what I would say to the court is that...
So are you citing that in support? Because I didn't think the state was all that pleased with the analysis he applied.
Well, what I'm citing...
Legal analysis, that is.
I'm citing what you specifically referenced as to the standard that is to be applied pretrial and post-trial, whether it makes a difference. And what I would say to the court is the answer is no, as it relates to the speculative nature of the allegations or the claims made by defense counsel as it relates to whether a conflict actually exists, Your Honor. What I can't do at the moment is point exactly to the page at the end of the state's argument. I can give you the page number as it relates to Judge McBurney's order.
I think I know what you're talking about, the footnote where he references the appearance standard.
Yes.
All right. I'm looking at it.
Further, in Lamb v. State, 267 Georgia 41, on page 42, it's a 1996 case where the court says, nevertheless, the conflict must be palpable and have a substantial basis. In fact, a theoretical or speculative conflict will not impugn a conviction which is supported by competent evidence. Now, I understand as it relates to the post-conviction factor or the status of the case being in post-conviction based on Your Honor's earlier inquiry, but I would submit to the court that as it relates to the issue of disqualification, that the standard is the same whether it's post-conviction or pretrial. In Bloomfield v. Bornstein, which is 247 Georgia 406, the 1981 case. In that case, it says the appellees have not shown us a case where a per se rule was applied to disqualify an attorney on the basis of an appearance of impropriety alone. The Georgia cases cited by the appellee do not stand for the proposition that a trial judge is authorized in Georgia to disqualify an attorney solely on the basis of an appearance of propriety, which further goes to the state's submission to the court that the standard is that an actual conflict must be shown, and that conflict that arises shows that there's a personal stake of the district attorney as it relates to their personal financial gain that's being alleged. So in the case that's been referenced by all parties here today, Whitworth v. State, 275 Georgia, Appeal 790, to the 2005 case. In that case, it says Whitworth's complaints are largely based on speculation and conjecture. Applying any evidence standard to the record, it is clear that the trial court did not abuse its discretion in denying Whitworth's motion to disqualify Morgan based upon his personal interest in his conviction.
Aren't we past the speculation and conjecture aspect of this, though? I mean, the original and the core of the financial allegation was that there is a relationship and that money has changed hands. There's maybe still an open question of where the ledger stands, but I think it was conceded that that balance could run in one way or in the district attorney's favor. Is that contested?
Yes. What's not contested is that a relationship did develop between...
And that purchases were made back and forth. That's the state's position.
That is the state's position, but they were made back and forth. The purchases were made back and forth either to equal the money that was spent by one party or the other. And if that wasn't done, cash was exchanged in order to equal the costs that were paid by either one of the parties.
Right. But that's a facted issue, whether it was, you know, split even, or whether it goes a little bit one way or another, or whether it's all the way $10,000 one way or another. That's a fact and issue as a result of the hearing, but it's no longer just the theory that money changed hands is no longer speculation or conjecture.
Well, I agree that money actually changed hands is not speculation and conjecture, but whether that money that changed hands had any financial benefit or gain to the district attorney, that is all speculation and conjecture. I would submit to the court, absolutely all speculation and conjecture to harass and honestly embarrass the district attorney based on some of the questions that were asked that had absolutely nothing to do with the proceedings that we were here. For example, the lien on her alleged house, that was highly irrelevant, had nothing to do with the proceedings and the exchange of money between the district attorney and Mr. Wade. And the point of that line of questioning was to, again, embarrass and harass the district attorney in a way that was very public, and in a way that was to impugn her character as it relates to that line of questioning in front of the court, in front of anyone watching the proceedings as it unfolded. And the language in Whitworth, I would again submit to the court, requires that an actual conflict must be shown, which is why the reference to speculation and conjecture is again a reference, because speculation and conjecture leads to or equals an appearance of impropriety, not necessarily an actual conflict, which I submit to the court is what is required based on the case law. So in State v. Sutherland, which is 190 Georgia Appeal 606, it's a 1989 case, and it says, while the prosecuting officer should see that no unfair advantage is taken of the accused, yet he is not a judicial officer. Those who are required to exercise judicial function in the case are the judge and the jury. The public prosecutor is necessarily a partisan in the case. If we were compelled to proceed with the same circumspection as the judge and jury, there would be an end to the conviction of criminals, which goes to the premise that the appearance of impropriety is to apply to judges, not prosecutors. Because if that standard was to be applied in the manner in which the Sutherland case is referencing, then there would never be a criminal prosecution, because the state is always going to appear biased as it relates to getting justice for the victims or righting the wrong as it relates to the crimes in which the defendant is been indicted or accused of. So I want to move into I guess the evidence that Your Honor saw and heard during the last couple of days, three total days of testimony, as it relates to the witnesses. You heard from Ms. Yurdy, who the state would contend is a disgruntled former employee. You heard from Terrence Bradley, also someone who is a disgruntled former partner. The text messages in the state's opinion show that he is vengeful. You heard from his own testimony here sitting before the court that all he did was speculate, and any information that he had and garnered and then passed on to Ms. Merchant was mere speculation. I believe he said that over and over again when asked if he had personal knowledge. My recollection is around 15 times he said he had absolutely no personal knowledge of a romantic relationship between the DA and Mr. Wade. You also heard from the special prosecutor, Mr. Wade, a former judge. You heard from the 80th governor of the state of Georgia, Roy Barnes. You heard from the first female elected district attorney of Fulton County. And you heard from her father, who was a 40-plus year practicing attorney in good standing when he left the practice of law. And what I would submit to the court is that Ms. Yurdy's testimony was nothing more than inconsistent at best. Based on what I referenced to the court earlier as it relates to the representations that were made by her counsel prior to.
Are those in evidence? Would his responses during a motion to quash, which weren't subject to cross-examination by defense attorneys, weren't even part of the evidentiary record of the hearing? Again, I'm just kind of puzzled by that. You didn't ask the question of Ms. Yurdy, what did you tell your attorney before coming here, and then we could have dealt with privilege issues and whatever else.
I would agree with the court. It's not in evidence, but it was a statement by an officer of this court to the court during a hearing related to her testimony and how we were to proceed with her testimony in this hearing. But it's clear that what was represented as to why she would not have, I guess, be an appropriate person to testify was that she had absolutely no knowledge of the romantic relationship. That was the basis of why her counsel was saying that she shouldn't have to testify, that she shouldn't be compelled
by the court. So then under that theory, if accepted, where did the incentive arise between Monday and Thursday for her to completely change things around?
Where did the incentive arise?
So she was fighting so hard to avoid the, if we're going down that road you proposed, she was fighting to have, not to come in here and testify at all. And then she comes in here and testifies. Why would she have testified the way she did if she didn't want to testify so strongly? If we're going down this road of trying to just gauge her interests and these kind of things, I don't know if I'm quite following that theory.
And I can appreciate that, but I would say the reason she didn't want to testify, I would submit to the court, is because this is an incredibly public forum where she would have to testify against a former friend and a former boss. And I think the change, I wouldn't qualify it as an incentive. What I would qualify is ultimately when she was forced to testify, right, a motive and a bias as to why she testified in the manner in which she did. When asked by Ms. Merchant as to the reasons for her leaving, she kind of danced around the issue. And then as Ms. Cross asked her about whether she resigned or forced to leave, she was fired, came out and said she was given the choice, you can either resign, but either way you're leaving. You're fired, or you can resign in a manner in which, she wouldn't be officially fired, and when she's trying to get future employment and things of that nature. So I would submit to the court that there is absolutely no incentive. An incentive is not why Ms. Yurdy's testimony changed, or the state would contend her testimony changed, but it was the reason she testified the way she did was because of her bias towards the DA, which gave her motive to what the state would contend is be less than honest before the court. And I would.
But if we're going to draw inferences based on her fighting the subpoena, why would she have fought it if she had such a bias and wanted to say these untruths?
Because she didn't want to come on national television and have to be exposed to the things that I don't know anybody who wants to testify before a court in a normal trial, a normal proceeding, but one of what I would qualify in this high profile of the nature, where everybody would be able to watch and learn as, what she has to say as it unfolds in the courtroom. And I'd further submit to the court, there is reference to she left the DA's office in the text message that were submitted, and I believe, what is it, Defense Exhibit 39, that it's because she released confidential information in the DA's office, from the DA's office, that led to her firing, that she wasn't.
And I know I'm just because it's more conversational, which I appreciate. I know I'm, I might be getting you off script, so I don't want to use up all your time if you need to get through some other things.
Next, Terrence Bradley, and I believe the one thing that the state and defense counsel can agree on, that he was less than honest at times during the proceeding and during his testimony. He, when pressed or asked by Mr. Sadow why he was fired, he basically chalked it up to a dispute between partners in a business. But when pressed by Ms. Cross, it was clear that that wasn't the reason. And what I would submit to the court, what has been referenced by defense counsel as baffling as to why the state would go into to such a topic area, the state, as all counsel has when appearing before the court, has a duty of candor. And when Ms. Cross knew she was going to have to cross Mr. Bradley, she knew he lied. And she had a duty of candor to the court, in the state's opinion, to expose that. More importantly, it goes to his credibility. And the statements that had been represented by defense counsel that he allegedly had made in the past. So it was important to bring that to the court's attention, because when a witness is testifying, the court is assessing their credibility and determined to whether to believe the veracity of the statements made by the witness or not. So that is the most important factor when determining whether somebody is telling the truth or a lie. Furthermore, he reluctantly, when pressed, finally admitted that he paid off the assault victim. You know, eventually it started with an escrow account and led to he did pay off the victim in that case. He testified over a span of 3 days, and like I referenced to the court, he must have said 15 times that he had no personal firsthand knowledge as it relates to the relationship between Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade. More importantly, when pressed by counsel, he could not pinpoint a time in which he knew that the relationship occurred. There were many instances in which he described that very well could have fallen within the time frame that was testified and by both Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade as it relates to the relationship beginning or transitioning into dating in March of 2022 and into the end of the relationship in August or the summer of 2023. And as I referenced to the court, the statements that Mr. Bradley made, the state would contend are inadmissible hearsay as it relates to the statements that he was pressed and asked about what Mr. Wade told him, because Mr. Wade was never confronted with those statements. And in order for impeachment to be proper, he must be confronted with the specific statements that are alleged to have been made in order to impeach him. Again, Mr. Bradley had every motive to lie. I believe the text messages are kind of clear, are very clear, as it relates to his disdain towards Mr. Wade, which due to the fact that, you know, he was expelled or exiled from a thriving law practice, and it was clear that the practice and Mr. Wade sided with the alleged sexual assault victim, which is clear. He assaulted her due to the fact that he paid her off.
And as I referenced earlier, Ms. Merchant represented to the court that Mr. Bradley had personal firsthand knowledge basically of it all, of everything, and that he would be able to basically be an impeaching machine. I think Your Honor referenced him as the star witness when you were addressing the claims that were made by Ms. Cross in relation to Ms. Merchant's representations to the court. And what I would submit to the court is that all Mr. Bradley's representations as it relates to whether or when the relationship between Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade began and whether they cohabitated, because that was a promise that was also made, that he would be able to impeach the investigators as it relates to cohabitation, was mere speculation, gossip, and innuendo. And this is, Your Honor.
The impression I got, and we can correct this while we're all here together, is that Mr. Bradley directly overheard a statement from each of these individuals that they could be impeached with. Ms. Merchant, is that accurate?
Directly overheard. Which ones are we talking about?
Well, essentially, that kind of seemed to be all of them. You had said Allen, Bond, Young, and then the investigators, Hill, Green, and Ricks, could all be directly impeached by statements overheard by Mr. Bradley.
Yes.
In reference to your question, the unequivocal answer was yes. And when Your Honor is looking through the text messages, I would submit to the court that the text messages don't even say or indicate what was represented to the court in relation to the good faith basis for this motion to disqualify as it relates to the testimony of and the ability to impeach witnesses through Mr. Bradley. What's been referenced by all counsel is Mr. Bradley's assertion of absolutely as it relates to whether the relationship existed prior to Mr. Wade's hiring. And the question in itself involves speculation because it asks, do you think it started before she hired him? And he says absolutely. He doesn't say he knows. He doesn't provide any context as to how he knows. And in these text messages and through his testimony with the court, the source of his information was unclear. What I would say to the court as to a lot of things, other than the one conversation that allegedly occurred between Mr. Wade and Mr. Bradley, and I would submit to the court that conversation never occurred. That would be the state's contention. And how do we know that? We know that because that conversation was not confronted, or Mr. Wade was not confronted with that conversation. And that is evidence, circumstantially, and I'd even say direct, as to that conversation not existing. Because based on the representation made by defense counsel, it would be clear that that would be a conversation that would have been relayed to, because it wasn't privileged, as Your Honor found, that would have been relayed to Ms. Merchant. And if that conversation happened, you better believe that would have been a conversation that defense counsel would have confronted Mr. Wade with and against. And the reason they didn't do that was because it didn't exist. Again, you heard from Mr. John C. Floyd III, the district attorney's father. As Your Honor heard, he was a well-respected member of the legal community for over 40 years. But the importance of his testimony was to provide the court with corroboration as it relates to the years leading up to the relationship that transitioned into dating between the district attorney and Mr. Wade. What he testified to is that he moved into her South Fulton home in 2019. The evidence of his moving into that home at that time was his Georgia driver's license, official government document. He further testified that not only did just Ms. Willis and himself live at the South Fulton home, but that he often would see on numerous occasions the significant other of Ms. Willis that was not Mr. Wade. He referenced that that person had a nickname of Deuce, and that he kept a lot of his belongings in the garage of Ms. Willis. He specifically said he kept a lot of his disc jockey equipment, is how he referred to it when before the court. He made very clear that he had never seen Mr. Wade at the South Fulton home that is owned by Ms. Willis. He made clear that he lived in that home with Ms. Willis and Ms. Willis alone, other than her two daughters who would occasionally visit that home until after February of 2021. But what precipitated the soon move of Ms. Willis to what I would reference as safe houses for her protection was a protest that occurred before her home in February of 2021. He then expressed to the court that Ms. Willis moved in the spring of 2021 and that due to these threats that were taken very seriously, he had only seen his child 13 times. He said in reference to the questions by defense counsel that were in a and I'm just going to be straight up with the court. It was they were trying to make Ms. Willis a liar, what is how I would submit to the court, in the sense that she testified that she was concerned for her safety and her family's safety, which included her father and her daughters, and that Mr. Floyd remaining in that home kind of rebutted all of that, made it so it wasn't true. But he testified that he stayed in the home because it was a home that she had put her blood, sweat, and tears in and was able to buy, and that he stayed in the home because there were there was constant officer presence. He told the court that he bought extra security equipment. He even went as far to tell the court that he slept in different rooms on different nights because he felt his safety was in such a concern. So I would submit to the court that that line of questioning was done in an attempt to discredit Ms. Willis, but failed, would be this, how the state would characterize it. Then he testified about the first time that he did meet Mr. Wade, which is in 2023 here at the district attorney's office. And he talked about how he kept cash in his home and why Ms. Willis kept cash in his home. And what I would, what the court should take note of is the state didn't ask Mr. Floyd about the cash in his home. That came out through the cross-examination of defense counsel. There was an implication that Mr. Floyd only did so due through his preparation with the state and his hearing and seeing news articles and clips related to the testimony that had occurred prior to him. But I would submit to the court that it's telling that that information came out through questions that were asked by defense counsel, which gives credibility to the statements that were made. And he further explained as to why he taught his daughter to keep cash in the home as it relates to financial independence and having a safety net. It was further testified that he had multiple safes and that he gave Ms. Willis his first lockbox, or her first lockbox, for situations as she described when she was testifying. And what I want to make clear is during Ms. Willis's testimony, it was pressed about the cash and where she kept it, did it follow her, where she laid her head, and things of that nature, trying to further discredit the practice that she had as it relates to keeping cash in her home and why she was had the ability to pay cash to Mr. Wade and other people and for other situations. And what the court should take note of is that there was no evidence that controverted that at all. Where was the evidence that controverted Ms. Willis's claim and practice of keeping cash in her home? There was none. In fact, the only evidence was is it was substantiated through the testimony of her father, Mr. Floyd. Furthermore, you heard from former Governor Roy Barnes, his testimony was significant and important because what I would how I would phrase it, Your Honor, is it debunks.
Let me, on this point, mm-hmm. and I think you might have had a more recent opportunity to review his testimony than I have. Mm-hmm. You say on the slide that she was the first choice to lead the prosecution. Was that actually his testimony, or was his testimony that he was asked to come aboard? Did he use the words that he was asked to lead?
Yes, it would be, that's my recollection, that he was asked to lead the prosecution. He was asked to he was asked to fill the position that Mr. Wade is currently in, which is the lead prosecutor. It was said in that way as well as it relates to the testimony of Mr. Barnes. So I think it would be very clear. My recollection is that he said lead, but what I can submit to the court that I know he also said that he was asked to fill the position that Mr. Wade is currently filling for the state of Georgia, which is the lead prosecutor.
At that time, as special grand jury prosecutor, right?
Yeah, as the special prosecutor lead the investigation, which led to the ultimate prosecution that we're here before Your Honor today. He also indicated that the reason he turned that job down was because it didn't pay enough. He said he had mouths to feed at his law firm, and that he also didn't want to live the rest of his life with bodyguards because he had lived that for the years in which he was the governor of Georgia. Furthermore, he confirmed the qualifications of Mr. Wade, which I still find it quite interesting and confusing as to attacking Mr. Wade's qualifications, in that it's almost as if Mr. Roman's counsel is asking that the state put a prosecutor on the case that she sees to be more qualified to attempt to convict her client. It's an interesting argument, and it's one that makes no sense. Furthermore, if you were to believe the claims and allegations as it relates to Ms. Willis' personal stake in the prosecution, the receiving of financial benefits and gains, then you'd have to believe that she was also dating Roy Barnes, the former governor, and Gay Banks, in addition to Mr. Wade. If she has this grand plan scheme in order to profit off of the prosecution of this case, because that's what they're saying. Or they're saying that she telepathically or prophetically was able to know that Mr. Barnes and Mr. Banks would turn down the position so she could then hire Mr. Wade. It's ridiculous. It's absurd. And it's desperate. It's in a desperate attempt to remove a prosecutor from a case for absolutely no reason, Your Honor, other than harassment and embarrassment. This slide, and we've been through a lot of the testimony.
And I should be clear there, it was not introduced in evidence that Mr. Banks turned her down, right? How's that part of the record?
Well, I'd ask the court to take judicial notices. Has been asked repeatedly.
Unless the district attorney had testified to that. I don't recall offhand.
I will be frank with the court. I don't recall if Ms. Willis testified to that exact fact, but I know that Mr. Banks represented that to the court during Monday's hearing as it relates to the allegations that were made. I understand Your Honor's position as it relates to that.
I'm just trying to make sure we know exactly what is in the evidence and is not, but... Well, regardless, I think your point is made.
I think it's an evidence of the record as it relates to, I guess, the issues that led up to the actual hearing of this case. So I understand Your Honor's position, but it did come out during a proceeding that was prior to the actual hearing. This slide is just a chart showing kind of the testimony of both the district attorney, Ms. Willis, and Mr. Wade, as it relates to how they met, when Mr. Wade became the special prosecutor, when their relationship evolved into a romantic one, talking about the trips in which they took after their relationship evolved into one that became romantic, and when it ended. And what, again, I would submit to the court is that those facts were consistent. And the only person who contradicted that when the relationship started was Ms. Yurdy. And what I would bring to the court's attention is that it was represented to the court that Ms. Yurdy was a witness other than Mr. Bradley who could
bring to the forefront this issue of cohabitation. And when pressed and when asked about it, Ms. Yurdie had absolutely no information as it relates to this alleged cohabitation. It was false. She said she had no information. She was asked about trips. She said she had no information about the trips. Yet, she's such a good friend that Ms. Willis confirmed each year that Mr. Wade and her continued to be in a relationship 2019, 2020, 2021, until their relationship ended due to her forced resignation and splintering of their friendship, Your Honor. Several exhibits obviously were tendered in. Most of them were exhibits that came from the sealed divorce of Mr. Wade and Miss Jocelyn Wade, contracts for legal services, trip itineraries, and the text messages. And I would specifically reference prior to today, the only text messages that were before Your Honor were defense exhibits 26 and 27, which it's the assertion of defense counsel that what those show is that Mr. Bradley had information as it relates to the relationship starting prior to March of 2022, and that's just false. Those text messages do not contain that. It does not pinpoint, just as Mr. Bradley couldn't, when the relationship actually started. And furthermore, you have the testimony and the evidence of the text messages that it was mere speculation. If you, as Your Honor, reviews the full chain of text messages, it is clearly Ms. Merchant and Mr. Bradley going through what I can describe as nothing else other than a mere fishing expedition about certain members of the DA's office who would have information as it relates to specifically, for one, Ms. Young. It is asked whether she would have information, and he had no idea. He said he assumed he was speculating. And that is the same as each person that was subpoenaed in reference in the text messages. All of that was speculation. And you know it was speculation because not a single one of them testified. That's telling. Because if it wasn't mere speculation, if it wasn't mere gossip, and if it wasn't mere conjecture, each one of those people who were subpoenaed would have been called to testify, like District Attorney Willis was, like Mr. Wade was, in order to be confronted and then impeached by Mr. Bradley. You've heard, obviously, about the phone records, and I have a maybe, because whether it comes into the purview of Your Honor as it relates to the determination Your Honor is to make as it relates to the disqualification of the district attorney. You also have the affidavit from the employee who worked at the winery who confirmed that Ms. Willis did in fact pay in cash up to more than $400. And I understand that this is part of the proffer of the state, but it's important because that is a witness who the state didn't go find. That is a witness who went to CNN in order to confirm what Ms. Willis testified to, further giving her statements credibility and credence before the court. You heard about...
Before we move on from that one, other than the foundational concerns, would you have a response to the proffer of the cell phone records?
I have... I'll get to that now. I was going to get to it later, but I have several foundational concerns as it relates to the cell phone records. I don't think I've ever, as Mr. Sadow's motion makes very clear, the state uses cell phone records routinely. And I would agree with that. We use them routinely. But we use them with an expert. And they're always challenged.
Right. So, like I said, in the interest of time, setting aside the foundational concerns.
Oh, I thought you were asking about them.
No. The focusing on the substance of them, assuming that it would be admissible in the guise that he's proffered. Maybe you have that further up, but what's the reaction to that?
So what I would say initially is that due to the fact that they were analyzed by someone who was a non-expert, the analyzation of those cell phone records were not properly peer-reviewed. They were not, it's clear from the state's review that the normal practices that are used to check the use of which kind of data is being used
In reference to the two specific dates, I believe it's September 10th and 11th and November 29th and 30th, the affidavit that is used to say that Mr. Wade remains at Ms. Willis's or in the area of Hayville, because again, during the hearing, the address for the Yerdy condo never came out. It was just that it was the Hayville condo. The actual phone number for Mr. Wade was never established. And the documents that were provided to the state as that were certified business records did not have a subscriber page. So we have no idea that the number belongs to Mr. Wade. Now, I understand Your Honor wants to look past the foundational issues, and I can appreciate that. But the foundational stuff is very important as it relates to the admissibility of the records.
No doubt about that. But if somewhere how they were able to survive those foundational concerns, do you have any reaction?
Yes, I do, and I will skip forward so I don't. So what's interesting is that the records that were provided they start in January of 2021, and they go, I believe it's to November 30th, I think is what the, of 2021, the span of the records. And you heard from all of the witnesses, including Ms. Yerdy, that Ms. Willis did not move into the Hayville address until April of 2021. That was the testimony from all of the witnesses, April of 2021, and that she lived in her South Fulton home from when she met Mr. Wade in October of 2019 up until when she had to move. And the assertion by defense counsel is that Mr. Wade and Ms. Willis began a relationship right after they met in October of 2019. What's interesting and what's telling is that Mr. Wade's handset doesn't once appear in anywhere near the area of her South Fulton home, but they're dating, but they're in a serious relationship. And if you were to believe what the defense counsel says, that they have been in a relationship from October of 2019 up until she moves in April of 2021. So, you know, a year and a half or so, but he never once enters the area of her home. But they want you to believe that that's a lie, which is why counsel for defense continued to press District Attorney Willis and Mr. Wade as to whether he had ever been to that South Fulton home. Well, this corroborates that that was not a lie, that he had never been to that home. And it's more than suspect if you've been in a relationship, as they claim, for all this time, but never once went to the house. So I think that's telling. What I would also bring to the court's attention in the state's initial review of the records, that from January of 2021 to March of 2021, those times when Ms. Willis did not live, again, at the Hayville address, she didn't move there until April of 2021, that his handset appears in that area 23 times.
Sure. How do you reconcile that with this testimony that was alluded to, I think, by opposing counsel, the reasons he gave for being in the area?
Well,
would those line up to 23 times? I think, you know, I think there are too many reasons for being there, right?
Well, I think that's the point. I would say yes, that is the point. He referenced that that's an area that he, it was not uncommon for him to be in, and it clearly that is the case because Ms. Willis didn't live in that area. So, again, it's further corroboration as to what Mr. Wade indicated to the court. And when, I guess, after Ms. Willis moved into the condo in April of 2021, they appeared 35 times. Now, I want to make clear to the court, both Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade never denied that he had been to that condo before. The specific testimony that was elicited by Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade was that he had never laid his head, was the direct quote, at that condo, which these records don't prove that he laid his head anywhere. If you were to believe the analysis, or if you were to give credence to what the non-expert says as it relates to Mr. Wade's handset on in September and November for the 3 to 4 hours that the phone is alleged to have remained, that doesn't disprove anything that that was testified by both Mr. Wade and District Attorney Willis. It was that he visited there. The specific hours of his of their visits was not something that was pursued during the questioning of both of the parties. So what I would also submit to the court is that if you look at the days as it relates to in September and November, the use, the type of information that is used to make the plots for the longitude and latitude of the handset is data records. It's not voice records. It's not SMS or text messages. It's data records. And it is not uncommon for an expert to testify as it relates specifically to AT&T records that that actual data record is unreliable as it relates to the location of the handset due to the type of information that it is, that it's data. It's not the voice and the SMS, which I know, Your Honor, as has been referenced, is, was a prosecutor not only here in this county, but for the federal government, where this kind of information is commonly used. So in the comments that were made by the court, it was clear that you understood and understand the use of cell phone records as it relates to put somebody in an area, and again, not in a specific location. I'd also bring to the court's attention, as it relates to the validity of the affidavit and the analysis done by the expert that was hired by Mr. Sadow, is that not once does it reference the fact that AT&T records commonly have duplicate and triplicate entries within the call detail records. That is something that is commonly seen, and that is something that is seen in these records. And that is something that leads to the incorrect number of times that has been alleged that Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade were in communication through text and voicemail. And I'd also submit to the court that that number doesn't prove anything again, doesn't prove that anybody's in a relationship. It proves that they were in communication with each other. And I think Your Honor can use your own life experience as it relates to people you work with or friends that you're close with, and the number of times that you make calls to any of those people. I can submit to the court that I have a friend who I have been friends with for 15 years, and she worked in the office previously with me. And based on our professional relationship and our personal relationship, the friendship that we had had and still have, that we talk 30 times a day. So that doesn't mean we're in a relationship. So the assertion that the number of times that Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade have spoken to each other, whether it's through text message or phone, it has no validity as it relates to them being in a relationship. What I would submit to the court is that what was shown through all of the evidence was that there's been a true cost to Ms. Willis as it relates to her life, that she had additional expenses that she had to endure because of her position, in the sense that she told the court that she had a mortgage, but on top of that mortgage that and a house she didn't live in anymore, she had to pay for a safe house, that her home was vandalized, and there were racial epithets and sexual bigotry that were spray-painted onto her house. The concern of her safety and her life is something that was testified to, and the fact that this job has led to the isolation and separation of her from her family and friends, which was given credence, and the credibility of those statements were provided by her father, Mr. Floyd, that he had only seen his daughter 13 times since all of these instances occurred. The statistical nature of the statements and the falsehoods that, for example, in these text messages that were purposefully leaked to the media as it relates to Ms. Willis's daughter, subjecting her position in school, that she flunked out of college, which isn't true, which in fact she has graduated from an HBCU. But what's been leaked to the media is the fact that she flunked out of school and someone other than her father moved her, which again, the validity of which was never shown. And all the while, Ms. Willis facing these costs has been able to continue to do the work unrelated to this case, which is shown in the fact that Atlanta's murder rate and violent crime rates have decreased while she has been in office. What was shown through the testimony of all of the witnesses and through the evidence that Your Honor heard was that there wasn't an actual conflict, that the defense failed to provide any sort of actual conflict in relation to Ms. Wade's, I guess, the relationship that transpired from the relationship between her and Mr. Wade, and that there was absolutely no evidence of a financial benefit that she gained as it relates to the prosecution of this case and the ultimate outcome of the case. The corroboration of all of that is the things that Your Honor is very much aware that she could have, I guess, financially benefited from stretching out the case, for lack of better words, by the grand or the special grand jury recommended that 39 individuals be indicted. But through her sifting through the special grand jury's report and all of the evidence with the team that indicted the case, they only went with 19 of the defendants, which had she gone to 30, gone with all 39, there's they're based on the defense counsel's assertions, would have given her the opportunity to certainly find these financial gains that are claimed through the allegations of defense counsel. More importantly, why would Ms. Willis repeatedly ask this court to set a trial date as soon as possible if her motive in prosecuting this case was to continue to financially gain, as alleged, from the prosecution of this case? It doesn't line up. It doesn't make sense. And it doesn't make sense for a reason, because it doesn't exist. More importantly, this office has several multiple RICO and as well as large-scale cases like this one, and much larger. And they also have, there's a lot of high-profile prosecutions. If Ms. Wade's, or excuse me, Ms. Willis's ultimate goal by hiring Mr. Wade was for her financial benefit, then she would put Mr. Wade on every single one of those cases. Though she could certainly revel in the riches and lavish lifestyle that has been referred to by defense counsel, which there's been absolutely no evidence of. The evidence was she stayed at a DoubleTree in Napa, a DoubleTree. I don't know that to be a lavish hotel. Most people, when they go to Napa, if they want to lavishly experience Napa, stay at the Ritz-Carlton, the Four Seasons, things of that nature, not a DoubleTree. So the allegations and assertions that Ms. Willis was living the lifestyle of the rich and the famous is a joke, absolute joke. As it relates to what you heard, and the secondary issue is the forensic misconduct, and for lack of better words, what it has to be shown is that the statements that were made by or here Ms. Willis related to the prosecution of the case and ultimately the guilt or innocence of the defendants. And we have none of those statements. There's been no evidence. Nothing has been provided to Your Honor as it relates to Ms. Willis's specific statements made about any of the defendants and in relation to the guilt or innocence of any of the defendants. I forget which defense counsel referenced the fact that she said she had a 95% conviction rate. Well, what Ms. Willis's job is to instill confidence in the community as to how well she is doing as it relates to her constitutional duties. And that was exactly what was done when she referenced that she had a 95% conviction rate from the previous year that she was serving as a district attorney. More importantly, it's been the allegations about race and religion being imputed in her speech, and that those comments were directed at the defendants at this table. And if you listen to the speech, those comments are directed at two elected or political officials. I believe it was Marjorie Taylor Greene and Ms. Bridget Thorne, who is a member of the Fulton County Board of Commissioners here. She specifically used their names. I don't know that they, and my knowledge is they're not supposed to be sitting at the table, and I haven't seen them in my work as it relates to this case, Your Honor. So those allegations that Ms. Willis committed forensic misconduct are, again, there's no validity to them. There's no evidence of them as it relates to any of those comments, which this is an issue that Judge McBurney has previously ruled on when these same allegations were alleged as it relates to extrajudicial statements made by Ms. Willis, and it involved a statement that the words fake electors were said by Ms. Willis, and he found there was absolutely no conduct that was impermissible as it relates to forensic misconduct. And I guess to drive home the point, at no point in any of the statements that were made and that are alleged here as it relates to the speech that she made at the church, at no point did she mention the guilt or innocence of any of the defendants. She, again, was merely responding to comments made by Marjorie Taylor Greene and Bridget Thorne, two other political officials, therefore making her comments not even close in the realm of any sort of forensic misconduct. What I find interesting is that defense counsel wants to make these allegations that Ms. Willis committed this forensic misconduct by the statements that she made in her defense as two unrelated, in this case, public officials criticized the job that she was doing. And, I find the hypocrisy interesting in the sense that we've had video proffers released to the media by defense counsel, emails between counsel released to the media by defense counsel, statements have been made by defense counsel in relation to this case. We had the unredacted version of the cell phone records of Mr. Wade released to the media by defense counsel with his private and personal information, causing the threat of harm to both Ms. Willis and Mr. Wade to increase. The most recent instance was the text messages that Your Honor hadn't ruled on their admissibility prior to their release, and it was made clear during the hearings that the ability to get those, the full chain, was something that they were unable to do. But they figured a way, and the minute they figured a way, they released it, the information to the media, simultaneously with turning it over to the state and the court. For all the reasons obviously stated before Your Honor, that this motion should be denied because the legal requirements by that are required in order for the district attorney to be disqualified have not been satisfied. The defendants have failed to raise any issue legally or factually to satisfy the legal standard for disqualification. They must show an actual conflict. They've been unable to show that the prosecution of this case was at all a result of political bias, which has been accused, or accusations have been made, as well as demonstrated that the prosecution of this case was motivated by any means or any way because of malicious prosecution. And they haven't been able to prove that this case was one of selected prosecution for political benefit or gain. All allegations that have been made during the course of different hearings and the procedures as it relates to this case. What I would leave the court with, and how the state started the argument, is that courts have been generally unreceptive, if not hostile, to attempts to disqualify prosecutors based on pervasive and institutional conflicts, which makes clear that the burden, that the standard is very, very high that must be met in order for an elected district attorney to be disqualified. And that burden, that standard has not been met. An actual conflict has not been shown. And more importantly, in conjunction with that, there's been absolutely no evidence that the district attorney has benefited financially at all, but benefited financially in conjunction with any outcome, whether it be now or ultimately as it relates to the prosecution of this case. And because of all those reasons, Your Honor, we respectfully request you deny defense counsel's motion to disqualify the elected district attorney, Ms. Fonnie Willis.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Abadi.
Your Honor, I think we have 5 minutes and 44 seconds.
That's what it says. Mr. Cromwell. Okay. Handing it over. Understood. Mr. Sadow, all yours.
I'm going to do rebuttal, specific rebuttal. One, state somehow makes an argument that we should have asked Mr. Wade questions about his relationship and his communications with Mr. Bradley when they objected over and over and over. And Wade's counsel objected over and over and over, claiming that everything that Bradley was told by Wade was attorney-client privilege. Your Honor made determinations thereafter to Bradley. We didn't get the opportunity to call Mr. Wade back to the stand. So to claim that you can't impeach him because you didn't ask him when they objected to us asking him is a false position to take, as disingenuous as it can be. Now, if the court wants to open it up, we'll be more than happy to call Mr. Wade back to the stand. But as the record stands, there could be no confrontation of Mr. Wade when both his counsel and the state are arguing that it shouldn't be done. Second, let's use a little common sense here. Forensic misconduct received about 2 minutes worth of discussion. The rest of it is all on conflict. Forensic misconduct dealing with the way the state wants you to have is if you don't accuse someone or you don't say that someone's guilty.
Yeah, assuming you can impugn someone's character to the degree that constitutes forensic misconduct, why is that?
I'm sorry, say that.
Assuming you can impugn someone's character to the degree that it constitutes forensic misconduct. I guess the state's primary position was that they weren't talking about you at the church.
Right. And if you go listen to it and watch it, it starts off by saying, why does Commissioner Bridget Thorne and so many others, and then it refers to they attack him for being black. They attack him, not anyone else, just they attack the black man. They're not talking about Miss Thorne or Marjorie Taylor Greene. They're talking about us. And you know how everybody knows that? Because not a single story from the media reported anything other than Fonnie Willis accused the defense and defendants of being racist. Now, here's the common sense part of this. If you follow the state's position on forensic misconduct, Fonnie Willis could all day long talk about race. She could say the defendants, I'm not saying they're guilty or not guilty, but they're racist. They're racist. They're racist. And according to the state's position on forensic misconduct, that wouldn't be a problem. Obviously, that makes no sense whatsoever. The issue here that we've dealt with on forensic misconduct is not simply the church speech. It's why she did it, how she did it, calculated, and all the other things that we talked about with the testimony of Wade and Willis in this case. Let's go to the relationship issues and the cell phones briefly. No one knew that there was a relationship between Wade and Willis, according to Wade and Willis. Not a soul was ever told that they were dating or that there was an intimate relationship, ever. They concealed it from all parties, from Daddy. Daddy didn't even know they had a relationship. Suggest that somehow in the beginning of 2021, January to whatever it was into April, that they couldn't have met in Hapeville. They didn't meet anywhere that would allow the public to see them. That's the reason why they were meeting at Yerty's, because no one else was ever there. Remember the testimony? Who else was there besides Mr. Wade and Miss Willis? Both of them agreed. No one ever went there except them. They didn't go to where Daddy was in Miss Willis's house because Daddy was there. And Daddy would know. No other prosecutors knew. No one knows, except who? The one person that knew was Bradley and Yerty. Yerty was the best friend at that time of Miss Willis, and Bradley was the partner of Wade. Now, the only way that Bradley can walk away from the, very little time, so I'll skip that. Let's go to something. Motive. That's an issue. Whose motive in this case is the strongest? Bonnie Willis, Nathan Wade. Because if they if they testify truthfully on every point. What happens if the relationship started before November 1st? They get disqualified. Who has the best motive of anyone to lie? They do. Who has the most at stake to lie? They do. Who wants to stay on this case for whatever the financial reason may be? They do. And
more. Thank you, Mr. Sena. There it is. All right. Thank you, everybody. I think it's been very much made clear by the argument and the made today is that there are several legal issues to sort through, several factual determinations that I have to make, and those aren't ones I can make at this moment. And so I will be taking the time to make sure that I give this case the full consideration it's due. I hope to have an answer for everyone within the next 2 weeks. Until that point, if there are any other issues that come up, counsel can reach out, and we'll have an order posted on the docket. Thank you all. We're off the record. Thank you, Mr. Thank you.